Are we on? Are we on? Are we there yet?
Are we there yet?
Did we make it?
Did you make it 10 seconds before we had
Literally,
to go live?
Both of us just sat down just this second.
I mean, I've been sitting in this room for hours.
Oh, not me.
No.
I don't like my lighting.
Hey, everybody in the chat and who's watching.
Hi, everybody in the chat, in the pates and the friends and the aliens and ghosts and wizards and witches. Hi, Josh. Hi, Cheryl. Hi, Kyle. Kyle, my meme lord.
You're supposed to start every one by saying if everybody can hear us all right.
Oh, can you hear us all right? I think that's what I meant by are we there yet? Are we here? Did we make it? Oh my God. Thanks, Cheryl.
I mean,
I haven't put on makeup in weeks.
You haven't put on makeup in weeks?
No, not really. I mean, maybe once, but I need a tan. I feel like the light I have on right now is washing me out.
Look at these bags because of the light in my room.
You look more tan than me.
I went out walking for 2 hours yesterday in the sunshine.
Do that. Hi from Ireland. Oh, hi. Hi.
And I went to the cemetery and I went to my bank.
Cute. All clear. Hi, Rhonda. Hi, Holly. Oh my God.
Oh my goodness. It's just this now?
Yeah, I can say hi to them if I fucking want. I talk to them every day. I talked to Holly fucking literally yesterday. I talk to all of them every day. Hi, Jinx. I talked to Kyle like an hour ago. They're my friends. Everybody's my friends.
We're all good friends.
Literally, Toad just gave me the side eye. Like, why is she yelling? Am I getting yelled at? Toad, come here and say hi. Toadski, come here. Okay.
Can we do a quick check on something?
What? Don't make my makeup.
How loud is this?
What?
Ready? Oh, wait, I don't want to scare Toad, but how loud is this?
Oh, that's good. That's good. It's loud, not too loud. What are you licking, little chicken? Does anybody have any questions for Toadathan? Woo? Ah, he put his ears up when I said it.
He looks like he's got chicken panic. Oh, does he see me?
Questions for Toad? He's like, did anybody bring me a toy or what?
Did anybody bring me a box I can rip apart?
Did anybody bring me a box? We did get a new box that's by the front door. I was wondering if he was going to bite it up while we're on here. Pretty loud, but appropriate. That's Woopod in a nutshell.
Did you notice? I got a disco ball.
Toad's middle name. He doesn't really have one. Obviously his shelter name was Cash, so he's like Toadie Cash unofficially. Toadie Cash. Oh, he had a young. Wow, I'm boring you already. Sorry. Am I boring you?
He's over it.
Big yawn.
Toadathan. Toadie Monk.
That's your friend?
Toadie Monk.
You guys always talk on here?
3 hours of talking to the dog.
You guys always talk on here? Yeah, we said we have special mystery guests, but it's literally just Toad for 3 hours. So
it's just Toad. It's a 3 hour Toad Fest.
Toad Fest! 2K24.
When I was reading all the potato chat, which was happening earlier before we came on in the chat, there was a lot of potato talk. How come I've never put it together in my head?
What?
And did you mean for this, or did it just happen naturally? I've never put together in my head pates and potates.
No, I did not mean that intentionally.
Can our pates be potates?
Yeah, they are potates. Officially, unofficially. Hi, Sybil. Gorgeous person. What else you got? What
do you got for opening convo?
I don't fucking know. We haven't talked in days because we didn't want to get talked out and then not have anything to talk to each other about or be sick of each other.
Can I poll you and everybody in the chat if this is normal behavior for things?
What? Oh, I forgot I can put comments on the screen and I haven't been putting any. Potate's gonna potate.
That's right.
That's all we know how to do.
All right, is this a normal thing to happen?
Okay.
Okay. I woke up. You know how we had that huge windstorm the other day?
Yeah, we've been having like a million of them.
Crazy. So I, whoa.
I know there's a race car going in front of my house. Sorry.
So I woke up the next morning and asked my Google what time it was, and it didn't answer. Mm-hmm. And I looked over and I realized the green light on my TV wasn't on. And I was like, oh shit. The wind knocked out all my power.
Yeah.
I walked out.
Listen, I'm trying to make my light look like yours so that if yours goes blue, pink, and then mine goes pink. And then if there was blue on my side.
Are you listening to my story, please?
Not really.
Try. Try and focus.
I don't know how. Okay, go.
My power was turned off.
Like you didn't pay your bill?
Yeah.
What a loser.
I was 4 days overdue.
Yeah.
For 1 month.
Yeah.
For $90.
See, this is where you think it's crazy, and I don't think it's crazy, because what bills do is they correspond with you. They send you a correspondence, and you answer it. So for you to tell me that there is something that you got in the mail that you didn't answer, that's a surprise to no one.
It had a due date of March 7th on my bill.
Well, then they were wrong, but you were probably late for the one before that. It like
becomes... No, it was 1 month.
Well, then fucking...
That's what I'm saying. And so I had to call and get it. I had to call and get it returned on, and I had to give them a $115 deposit to turn it back on.
That's not right. That's not fair.
Plus a $20 credit card usage fee to get it. So it ended up costing me like $300 to pay a $90 bill that was due on the 7th.
No, you need to get on a customer service chat and complain at their asses. I'll do it.
Jesus Christ!
I get out of shit all the time. I will complain for you if you don't want to do it. Oh, you know what really, this is really boring, but do you know what actually works really well? Because I feel like it keeps a record of it or something. When you complain to companies via their chat, it gets stuff done so much faster than on the phone, because they're like, oh fuck, there's record of us knowing about this. And you can screenshot it. So if they're wrong, you can be like, well, I talked to your chat and they said this, and then you have a screenshot, and then they're fucked.
I asked the lady on the phone, I said, can you look back through to see if something has changed in my billing? Because I've been here for 13 years and I've never had my power shut off. And she goes, hold on. And she types. And then she goes, yeah, this is the first time it's ever been shut off.
Yeah. What do you fucking think I am, Melissa? That's my whole life. If he would have told me about this sooner, it would already be done.
So anyway, there's my bill. Opening monologue.
Complaint. I know you're a mess.
I'm a mess. See?
Yep, you got to do the chat. Nope, no talking on the phone. No phone. You got to do the chat.
I tried the phone. I did the phone.
Yeah, you
got it. Cost me $300.
You got to do the online chat. It works.
It cost me 300 buckos.
Is it just buckarines? No, I'm not going. I have no plans to go, but Kenny will be there.
I will be there.
See, Kyle gets it. Chat, so there's receipts. Boom. Chess is right. Chat is the way to go. Boom. Listen, this is another secret. If you have a brand, or it works really well with DTE too, our power company. If you chat, if the brand that you're complaining about has a Twitter page, like DM their Twitter, and it works so fast. I swear, so fast, even faster than the chat on their own website. It's weird. So try.
But that's like, isn't that the new thing though? Like where all the chats are just like AI bots now?
Yes. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi. Good to be here.
How are you doing?
How goes it, John? Jessica?
We're literally talking about the most boring shit ever. Thanks for.
I was talking about electric bills.
Electric pills?
Yeah.
The electric bills. Getting my power turned off and turned.
Oh,
back
gosh. Sure. Yeah. Nothing like a good bill in the mail. I get a couple of those every now and then. They're always a delight. Yes.
Stupid.
Mm.
Okay, so our first guest, you like Charlie or Charles?
Charlie is colloquial. Charles is just for credits to seem more real in the film world, you know? People
That's
call me Charlie.
Yeah. Perfect. Okay, this is Charlie Piper. He wrote one of my favorite horror movies that has come out recently called Destroy All Neighbors. It's insane.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
You co-wrote it with Well, one of the co-writers is Mike Benner, who mm-hmm. writes for Bob's Burgers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's incredible. Yeah, he was the first kind of punch-up writer who took the script past my early drafts. And then the second is this wonderful stand-up comedian, late-night writer, Jared Logan. The end result is kind of a melange of the three of us, kind of all the brains mushing together. And yeah, it's been a wonderful collaboration, really.
And it's all full of wonderfully weird people. I was like super on board because I'm a big, yeah. I listen to a lot of podcasts and watch a lot of comedy and stuff. Mm-hmm. So even like when, and I think I'm think this is correct. Like mm-hmm. even in the credits when it said that music was done by Brett Morris.
Yes. Yes. So
I was like, holy smokes.
Yeah. The music for the film is done by Brett Morris and Ryan Katner. They're both beyond what Brett does for all the podcasts and comedy scene. They're part of one of my favorite bands since 2005, a band called Man Man.
Yeah.
Brett did guitar and Ryan is the lead singer-songwriter. And Ryan plays the arrogant asshole musician Caleb Bang Jensen in the film. So that's been a trip. Everyone involved in this are some of my favorite people. And yeah, I have been listening to Man Man forever. And when I initially started writing this for the director, Josh Forbes, a decade ago, we did a sizzle trailer of just old horror movie footage to kind of fit the vibe. We literally had Man Man music in that as an example of how we wanted the film to sound.
Oh, that's cool.
It's been very exciting. Yeah.
So 10 years?
I started writing the initial drafts literally a decade ago. And it was because I had an actual horrible neighbor. He lived right behind me here through this wall. And one day I started complaining to Josh about this guy and what a non-surprise for living in the neighborhoods in LA we did. He also, Josh had a psychopathic neighbor as well. So we started pooling our frustrations together to get it out onto the page into a screenplay. Because we thought better to kill them on the page than in real life, you know, less paperwork police-wise to do after that. And yeah, it just started as a collaboration between the two of us as friends, you know, and it just kept going and slowly and surely grew into what came out, like a month and a half ago, finally.
Yeah. So. What you're talking about initially, like before it even got scary or creepy or gory or whatever, with the initial knocking, he has all that shit on his wall and he has just stuff. I'm like, this is my fucking nightmare. Like as somebody who's OCD, who has their posters all fucking perfect and aligned, if somebody was knocking my shit off.
Yeah, I feel that. And that was the neighbor I actually had would keep me up all night blaring EDM and 80s music. He was a huge cokehead, so I could hear him snort through the wall and howl and pound and scream. I dealt with him as a neighbor for about 2.5 years. And the only reason he ended up getting evicted is because I secretly filmed him threatening my life. And I was able to use that footage as leverage against the property manager landlord at the time.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was really bad.
This movie's like your life then.
This, I mean, it started as my life and evolved into something way more happy and funnier. And the early drafts were less comedic because I was literally writing them while being kept up at night by the neighbor. So,
yeah.
But the end result, it's sweeter, it's funnier, but it's still, yeah, very much what I went through, just kind of transmogrified a bit. Yeah.
Do you what are the chances that this neighbor's going to see this movie and you like literally wrote about killing your fucking neighbor?
That has been a fear. I mean, when he got evicted, I hid at a friend's place in Burbank for that weekend because I didn't want to, you know, my apartment, like it's a lot of windows, right? So I was like, this guy's just going to break in and try to kill me. But it was sort of classic bully behavior. Once he was evicted, once his modicum of power was gone, he just faded away. Last I looked, he pretended to be a small business during the quarantine years and got money, but then got found out. So I think he went to court. He might be in jail. I'm not sure.
Mm. Oh my God. Yeah. Wait, before we go any further, should we play the clip real fast so people have an idea of what we're talking about?
That could help. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can do that. I think
it's a horror comedy and it's so
this fun. Is Charlie. This is the first time we've played a clip on one of our live shows.
Yeah.
So I don't know how, let's see how well it works. Here we go.
William, use your demons. Don't let them use you.
No! So you've killed somebody. Relax. Just need to know how to get rid of a body.
You
really?
I'm not a mass murderer. I'm a mass manslaughterer.
It's time to make a hit record.
I'm alive.
Shut up.
You didn't hear that, did you?
You yelling shut up at nobody? Yeah, I heard. It was very loud.
That is not what rock and roll is all about.
Let's rock!
You're a loser and you're gonna die a loser.
That worked.
Yes.
That worked.
Yeah.
Dude, Pamela and Johnny, when his little part took me out. He like stole the whole movie. It was so
just
fucking
so
funny.
Good. Yeah.
Just
it was
so dry.
Yeah, it was awesome to have him. And we had him because, you know, Jonah and him are pretty much best friends. They've been friends forever. They used to be comedy hosts of a live comedy show here in LA called The Meltdown. Mm-hmm. So then all these years later, he ends up being the smelting guard. And it was just a coincidence, but kind
that's
of
pretty funny.
But yeah, we have so many great comedians in it and actors. It's been a blast.
The only time I did stand-up comedy was at Meltdown in California.
Oh, no, there you go. It's I miss that place a lot. It was a great comic store, great space in the back.
Yeah,
I was always lurking in the Fantagraphic section, you know. That's my jam, yeah.
I walked in there and saw a bunch of Ultraman stuff and was immediately on board.
I love Ultraman. Shin Ultraman was amazing. I saw the North American theatrical premiere of that at Fantasia up in Montreal 2 summers ago. Blew my mind.
Yeah, I saw it in Detroit, and I was over the moon.
Yeah, it's so funny. It's so good. Yeah. I'm a big Godzilla, Japanese cinema, and just all that stuff in general. I met, I'm going to probably pronounce it wrong, but when I was a kid, I met Hiro Nakajima at a Chiller Theater horror movie convention back in New Jersey.
Oh, that's amazing.
He was the original suit actor from the 50s to the 70s. Didn't speak any English, and there I was, like, you know, like 9 or 10 years old, you know, like 4.5 feet tall, just like shaking at him. I'm sure he was just like, whoo.
But I love it.
I love that stuff.
Only recently did Jessica realize that there's a baby Godzilla, and she was
four. I love you. Minya Manila. There's a couple of translations. It's adorable, and the soundtrack is hysterical. That kind of whoop, 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 music he has.
In my, I don't know what it was, but it's just the American stuff. It'll always be Minya to me.
Yeah, I hear you. I like Minya. I think that sounds the best too. Yeah.
Uh-oh, Jessica, take over because I think I have to reboot my computer.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Okay. I was gonna bring up too. The effects guy, one of the effects.
Hell yes.
I worked on Leprechaun and Gremlins 2 and Crawl Space, which is one of the weirdest movies ever.
That's the one with Kinski, right? Yeah, that one's pretty bonkers. He told me a lot of stories about being on set with Kinski, and just it was terrifying from what I could hear. But so he's another. So I literally grew up watching Gabe Bartalos's monsters. You know,
yeah,
he did Leprechaun. He was on Gremlins 2. He did Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2. He did Matthew Barney's Cremaster Cycle in the 90s. Okay, are you kidding me? The art form of me. If you remember when Bjork wore the swan dress to the Oscars. The egg she dropped out of the dress at the beginning of the red carpet, Gabe designed that.
Oh my God.
A very funny thing. One job, is that Toad?
Yeah.
I love that dog. I saw the footage of, you sent me the footage of Toad watching Mal Castraca, which also has Gabe effects.
I want to get to that too, but.
Yeah. Anyway, so I got a job at Gabe's effects company about 12, 13 years ago through Craigslist, just the one time in my life I got a good job, and it ended up being the most important connection of my life, because now all these years later, I work with him. I was an assistant painter, and they had been building out a miniature of the entire county of LA for an eccentric Dubai billionaire who had bought a house in Beverly Hills, carved out the living room, and wanted the miniature of LA to be placed into the floor and then covered in plexiglass, so he could James Bond villain lord over it. And they had been building and painting this for about 2 years before it came on. It was maybe like 30 feet long, 50 feet wide. Each area had like 5 to 10 exact replica buildings and then smaller repetitive ones to fill the gaps. Mm. And they ended up getting it all fiber optically lit from within. So I was there and I was just painting these miniature buildings all day. And I really lucked out because I was in my early 20s. I was an intern, you know, barely paid. And, you know, effects companies, they get a lot of like young, eager, like horror obsessive weirdos like this, right? Where you know, there are dozens of us in LA, so to say, right? But I walk in, and the first thing I recognized wasn't a film reference. They had a full-scale replica of one of the last sculptures by the amazing Polish artist Zukowski, who's one of my favorite artists. So I was like, holy shit, is that a Zukowski? And Gabe is like, oh, dude, you know Zukowski? Mm-hmm. Turns out Zukowski is one of his favorite painter, designer, sculptors, and he had been working with the Zukowski estate to recreate. So from day one, Gabe knew I was just as much into weird European art as film, and we just hit it off, and we've been working ever since. So
that is crazy. I saw, obviously, like, at first glance, whatever, I saw a lot of like Leprechaun in.
Oh yeah, style. And also, if you look up Gabe, like, it looks like him. All his creatures have that kind of. Gabe looks like Anton LaVey if he was a weightlifter. Like, he's this very beefy, big guy. And yeah, his sculptural sense, like, there's two different types of effects people. There are people who design realistic creatures and they just look real. Then you have someone like Gabe where he's a sculptor first. So all his stuff has a distinctive look. And yeah, it's a lot of people who didn't know the Leprechaun connection are like, Alex Winter looks and sounds like a leprechaun in this. And I'm like, okay, you're not too far off. Like,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. Also, yeah, you brought it up briefly, but your short film, how do you say it again?
Malacostraca is how I say it. I could be wrong. It's the title. Never say never, but it's the scientific Latin name for the largest crustacean genus subfamily. It translates to soft shelled crustaceans, and the film revolves around a crawdad. But yeah, having decided that title like over a decade ago, it means I've had to say it so much and confuse so many people. So.
No, I love it. Also, I've watched it twice now, and you brought it up, but the dog flipped out the first time he saw it because there's, I'm not going to ruin anything, but there's a creature in it. And when the creature came out, I don't even know how he even remotely knew what it was, but he was into it. So he
was incredible.
Yeah, watch the creature the whole time. And then I rewatched it a couple of nights ago just to have it fresh in my mind. And I was in a different room with a smaller TV. And I'm like, he's not going to notice it. And he fucking woke up and looked at the thing again. He's obsessed with that thing.
That's remarkable. Yeah, I don't. Yeah. Yeah, that was, I'm very proud of that short. For the long story short, for those who don't know it, which is most people, because it's just a short. That short took about 5 years to get off the ground. I wanted to make sure I had enough money to pay the cast and crew properly for it. I was going through some health issues at the time. So it was a lot of pre-production. There was literally a year of development just on the puppets with Gabe and balancing that out. But yeah, the short came out 2018, did the fest circuit, did pretty well. It premiered online a couple months before the pandemic, the quarantine. And then it kind of got, you know, it's out there, it can be found. It's also on Shudder, as well as being on YouTube and Vimeo. And I do now have a feature-length screenplay expansion of it that is one of the things that might get out there. So we'll see.
It played to me, too, like an episode of Creepshow. Like the Creepshow that they've redone now, too.
Yes, yes.
I'm like,
yes.
This could slide right in there, and it would be so perfect.
I would not say no to getting to direct a Creepshow episode if Shudder is out there listening. I mean, I'm already talking to Shudder about stuff, but Creepshow, I would not say no to that, too. So.
Yeah, it's perfect. I want to wait till Tenny gets back to bring up the UFO stuff. But,
we can get into that. Yeah.
Yeah. But we can bring up you. Not that many people have seen it yet because it's barely out yet. But I got a screener, and I assume you got a screener, or you went and saw it somewhere. But Stop Motion, we're both obsessed with the new movie coming out, Stop Motion.
Yeah, I've been a fan of Robert Morgan's stop motion animated short film since the early days of YouTube when I discovered his. I believe it was his college graduation film in the late 90s. It's called The Cat with Hands. Blew my mind. I started watching all his other stuff. And about half a decade ago, maybe a little longer, I was at AFI Fest at the Chinese Theater, and his 30-minute long stop motion short called Bobby Yeah played. And when that thing was over, I was like, well, that's it. Can't be outdone. He did it. We're good. No more stop motion. Thank you, Various. I would do a Creepshow if I could. But yeah, so this is his first feature film, and it's live action, but with stop motion. About a stop motion animator, and she's kind of losing her mind. And I come from a stop motion background and now work in live action, but with stop motion and puppets. So yeah, the film, it Yeah, it's incredible. And I believe it comes to Shudder within the month. So
yes.
And it's in theaters now, very limited release.
Yes.
Yeah, that's how I saw it, at least. So, yeah, I saw it at the AMC City Walk Theater in Universal Studios. It's just like the most touristy, bonkers, like the visual discrepancy of seeing that film then walking outside to like, it was
yeah. Wild. Yeah, it's such a, yeah, it's a grimy movie. After it's over, you're like, ugh. Like it definitely yeah. stays with you for a minute. The gore in it is really good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it got me squeamish a little, which is extremely difficult to do since I've been watching horror films since I was 6 years old.
So. Same. Okay, now he's back. I'm like, one of Tenny's guests is literally in the green room and he's not on the screen.
I'm on my phone.
Yeah, your internet sucks.
Oh my God. It's not, it's my computer was updating.
All right, I'm going to let your guest in.
Let him in.
Charlie, you stay here. We have guests overlap. It's a whole, we don't know.
All good. I'm good. I'm here for a bit of time. It's all good. Hello.
Hi, Eric.
What's up, guys?
Eric Lang.
John Tenny, my brother from another mother.
It's nice to meet you officially. I've heard so much about you.
Hi, Jessica. Nice to meet you too. Hey, Charlie.
Hello, Eric. Hello.
What are we doing? What is happening?
Let me tell people what you're known, some of the stuff you're known for, because you're known for a lot, but Escape at Dannemora, brand new cherry flavor. Shit.
Brand new cherry flavor. We got stuff to talk about. I love that. Hell yeah.
You saw it.
Let me just stop right here. That's one of my favorite things Netflix has ever put out, ever.
It's so gnarly. It went to places. And I'm a horror writer, director, and I do a lot of body horror and practical puppet stuff. So when I saw that, I was like, there we go. There's some people doing it. This is great. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, Netflix kind of buried the thing, you know. But making it, I was like, this is the craziest thing I've ever done.
Yeah.
Which is our wheelhouse.
Oh, yeah. But speaking of body horror, it's that him sticking his arm in her rib cage to have rib cage sex or whatever. I mean, what are we? Yeah. Look, Mom, I'm an actor.
It's pretty gnarly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's
anyway, so,
good.
So yeah.
Like somewhere Cronenberg perked up.
So I'm an actor person and just a tremendous fan of Mr. Tenny. And now Ms. Jessica. And Mr. Charlie and John and I have been on a couple ghost hunts, and I've been fascinated with the paranormal for like decades and decades. And
we met what, like 12 years ago at the Stanley, or 13 years ago at the Stanley Hotel?
Yeah, it was a long time ago. But like I weirdly, that's when it all started, because I had a house that like some weird stuff happened in, and my buddy had a podcast, and he's like, come on the Halloween episode and tell the story. And while I was on that episode, he had Britt Griffith.
Oh, right. Mm-hmm.
And he's like, it was a surprise to me. And he's like, I'll come to your house and we can investigate it. And by the time Britt came, everything had kind of calmed down. And I'm like, I don't really want to stir it up again. But we became friends, and then he introduced me to Amy, and then he invited me to the Stanley, which is where I met John. And I've just been a nerd about this stuff ever since. So I'm so happy to sit with you guys on this thing for a minute.
Yeah.
And comments over here. Thank you, guys.
You did an investigation with us at Waverly and had like your real ghosty experience that like, afterwards you were like, I want more of this.
Oh my God. Yeah. I had this experience with in the children's wing of Waverly with a ball that just moved in ways that made no physical sense. And I was like blown away by it. And I remember showing you, John, and I was like, what do you think? And you said, what do you want me to tell you? Do you want me to tell you that it's real, or do you want me to be skeptical? And I was like, that's such a Tenny answer, you know. Anyway, it's just like, it can't, you know, getting your fingers around it and your head around it is so difficult. But I did watch something last night called the Enfield Poltergeist.
That's a classic case. Yeah,
right? It's a classic case, but I didn't know this existed. But it's on Apple now.
Yeah.
It's a 4-part series, and all of it is using the real audio.
Yeah.
And then they have actors mouth the actual audio, so it feels like you're watching.
Oh, and that's clever.
It creeped me out so much. I watched one, and I'm like, wow. I need to take a break.
How they had them, you know, mouth the words. Something about it, because it was on, but it's also a little off, and I'm like, something about this is making it so fucking creepy.
Yeah. Yeah, for a minute I was like, they're not lip-syncing this. This is just their voice, and they're lying to us because that's possible. But it seems like it is. Anyway, I don't mean to go on and on as I first walk in the door here, but I'm excited to see everybody and to be here. Wow.
No, we're stoked.
I just turned Jessica on to a British kind of pre-found footage movie that was made in 1992 where the BBC pretended to go to a haunted house. Ghost Watch.
That thing is terrifying. Mr. Pipes, right? Or
Mr. Pipes, yeah. The scariest fucking ghost ever.
I'm right there with you.
Wait, I gotta write this down.
Terrifying.
Yeah, you have to watch it.
Where can you watch it?
I think it just came to Shudder this month, as of today. It's on Shudder.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you go on Shudder, it's rentable on Prime for like $4, I think.
Oh, there you go.
Oh yeah. Man. Okay.
Well, we do love Shudder. Just sign up for Shudder.
I find it hard to, Charlie, be interesting to get your 2 cents. I find it hard to find like really good horror films.
I'm right there with you, and I've been watching them for so long and writing them. It takes a lot to freak me out. A lot of them are just become funny or strange to me. And I love funny. Like, my latest is straight up, it's a comedy with blood. I wouldn't even call it it's a splatter comedy. But the things that freak me out the most, like Ghost Watch really gets to me, even though I know it's not real. It's just done so well. And it has people from the BBC at the time. So it just feels very real. But no, I like a lot of like psychological, like stuff like, I think Possession is one of my favorite horror films. It's from 1981, Sam Neill, Isabella Gianni. Shot in Berlin before the wall fell, and the wall becomes a visual metaphor for it.
Oh my god,
it's so bleak and intense. Yeah,
I loved Barbarian.
Oh, Barbarian was super fun because they did so much clever stuff with timing and.
Well, I expected nothing from it, and it was the right kind of creep. Like I like low, you know. I don't like all the music, and I don't want it to feel like a movie. I want it to feel like. Did you guys watch that weird one, Gobbledygook, or what's it called? No, not that.
Oh, Skinamarink. You're talking about Skinamarink.
Gobbledygook.
Skinamarink got to me, but because my parents actually had that exact same VHS tape of royalty-free old cartoons, and I remember being a kid, being sick up at night, and watching that while I was having fever dreams. So that film specifically spoke to me. But I think that's the sort of film that either are horribly creeped out by, or you're just like, this is an hour and a half of static shots of corners.
Or it's Eraserhead. You know, it's like,
I love Eraserhead. Hold on, let me show you something here.
Look at all these comments. I'm sorry, I'm not paying attention over here, guys.
Just talk. We're just having a party.
I'm glad to know that more than three people watched Brand New Cherry Flavor.
Speaking of Eraserhead.
Oh my god, you have an Eraserhead baby. Did you make that?
Yes, I made this. I went as Henry Spencer, the lead character for Halloween a couple of years ago, and so I built the baby to carry with me, and now it just lives in my wonder cabinet.
Oh my god, I want one so bad. There's like people make them on Etsy, but they're not like that big.
No, yeah, I did it full scale. But I've seen a lot of the cute Etsy ones too, which are nice.
Oh my god, I want a Eraserhead baby.
Wow.
I saw you have the little goblin from your little your stop motion short.
Yes, that's his name is Grumbo. I built him initially 12 years ago for a music video and then recently did a re-edit to make it more character driven. And what's funny about this is in terms of goblins and supernatural synchronicities, this goblin synchronistically got me connected to the Newkirks from Hellier, which is I've been a fan of, and I'd watched it and followed them online for years. And like maybe 5-6 years ago, they retweeted someone who had sent them a GIF of my goblin. And I was like, oh my god. So I messaged, like, I made that goblin like 10 years ago. And it was about the tones of a song waking it up out of a cave and going on an adventure. And so we've been friends ever since. So I love that guy. He's, yeah, he's sort of my mascot. Yeah.
I love that little guy. God.
He's so back cute. To my normal.
Penny's back.
Yeah. And your normal pink backlight.
But Charlie, I don't know if you remember this or not, but in the first season of Hellier, I tell them, be careful because you'll go crazy.
Yeah, no, I remember that very well. And I feel like I've been crazy for a long time. And I'm right there with it. I love Hellier. I look forward to what comes next with all of that and everything in general. It was wonderful stumbling across Hellier back in the day because it felt like, oh, finally I found people who are approaching the paranormal from a similar mindset as me, you know, reading these books and having a sense of humor about it, but being serious and open at the same time. Yeah.
It took a long time. I mean, cause I did my first lecture in 90 and everybody was so serious about it.
Yeah.
And so like when I started doing what I call weird lectures, people were like, well, why are they weird? And I'm like, cause it should be fucking fun too.
Yeah.
Like we're talking about fucking invisible apes and like flying saucers.
Like honestly, I was never big into Bigfoot until I was like, oh well, if he's an interdimensional emissary or some sort of bring on the interdimensionality, just the levels of it. And I love all that stuff. And
I was gonna say, let me see if I can do this. Can I present a slide? My computer.
I'm gonna pull all of us off on accident.
I'm gonna try and do this? No, I don't think I can. Wait, present. I wanted to show you what I think of whenever I think of kind of the crazy. How do I do this?
Oh, I can't. Katie Webb said, I ate a bunch of edibles and watched Skinamarink and vibed out so hard.
that might be the best way to see it.
That's an idea. I didn't have that when I.
He's like my BFF, and we talk about Eraserhead like every fucking day and tweak out about the Eraserhead baby. So it's so like right when you held it up, I looked in the chat. I'm like, hey, he's gonna go crazy. It's Eraserhead baby.
Eraserhead is a cornerstone of my obsession. And it's funny because a lot of people think I made Malika Straka that short as a response to Eraserhead. Yeah. And I didn't, but it speaks to similar themes in terms of parental fears and, you know, having a baby with the wrong partner and feeling trapped in it and all.
That's what I love about Babadook.
Babadook is great. I have the book here as well. I have the exact replica book over there. I need to keep my plugged in now, but yeah, Babadook is great. Jennifer Kent is incredible.
That's what I mean when I talk about like weird people coming to it.
These look like they could be extras from Parks and Rec or something. That's great.
Now, Eric, that was you working with my arch nemesis, Tony Shalhoub.
Tony! Yeah. That was a very weird episode of Monk. Late in Monk's run when they were running out of ideas,
always go to UFOs and ghosts.
Yeah, I mean, well, I wish they could do them
just
more.
For the record, and we can get another kind of, but I have the UFO thing to talk about, but also a couple months ago, I think it was before we got connected, I had my most inexplicable ghost moment I've had in my entire life, and it happened on Halloween night. So it's So long story semi-short, I've lived in the same building for 14 years now, and it's this older building. I think it was built, old for LA, okay? So it's like, this was built in the 60s. Wow, but that's not the main thing. My property manager was an older man, and I've known him forever. He lived at the base of the stairs. I'm upstairs. He's downstairs. And he'd been in ill health for quite some time, heart issues. He'd been in a motorcycle accident, limped. And I woke up on Halloween morning, that Tuesday, to a text from a friend of mine who lived in the building saying, oh, my God, our property manager's died. And I just saw him. What? So I text back and forth. He was walking through the courtyard and he heard whispering voices. And he thought, oh, maybe the police are there. Maybe someone robbed him. So he peeks in the door. The old man is on the floor. The sheet had just gone down. And the voices were the EMTs. And they look up. He looks up. He backs off. He leaves. I was asleep for about another hour. And then I'm like, oh, my God, because I literally have to go past his door to get out. And so I leave and the police are still there and I talk to them. They confirm he had a heart attack and that everything's being sorted out. I go around the corner to the local coffee shop and just feel weird as hell because it's Halloween. So everyone's out. It's also it's LA, right? So there's like people in costume and their dogs in costumes and kids running around. It's like 75 degrees. It's just all very odd. And I'm like, I love Halloween for the creepy, ooky, spooky skeletons, the childhood glee, but someone I knew for 14 years died at the foot of my steps, right? And just the feeling of knowing you're passing through space that a dead body had occupied that only hours ago was someone you knew. My friend went to work. When he got back from work, he was like, come on down to my place. We'll talk it over, you know, pour one out for him, right? My friend is a little bit of an eccentric writer, director, painter. And a couple weeks before, he had bought a couple old like paraffin oil lamps because he liked the idea of fire at night, or fire, you know, a flame, a candle when he was painting. So there's this like gothic romance candle novel cover looking thing in front of me. I'm sitting there. He's sitting there. All the lights are off. Halloween night. We're talking about how weird it was that he passed away. And he had sort of a rascally sense of humor. Like I liked him more as a person than a property manager, perhaps. But I literally said, man, wouldn't it be funny if he was like silly to us in life, like he was in death? The moment after I said that, the glass top of the oil lamp rattled, popped off of its own accord, rolled over towards my friend and fell off the table. My friend grabbed it to catch it so it didn't break. Then he screamed because it was hot as hell from the flame. He puts it down. I look at him. He looks at me. None of our hands were near this thing. The, you know, the flame's gone out. Mm-hmm. He's like, oh my God. And you know, it's one of those where you have the crank at the bottom and he'd have the flame crank to the lowest just because he doesn't want it like creating smoke. Mm-hmm. You know, we let it cool off for a moment. He puts it back on. And what's made it even trickier, the glass top doesn't just sit there. It's held in place by three metallic prongs that hold it to the bottom. So to lift it off without the bottom coming off, we tried it. You have to have one hand holding the bottom and put pressure to pop it off. So he places it back on, relights the candle, which had been set to the lowest thing. It relights all the way to full power with the flame flickering above it, even though he hadn't cranked it. So he shrieks and turns it off again. We decide, let's go somewhere else for a drink. This is a bit much. We go to a nearby bar and talk about it all. We go back home. And then that night, I open up my Instagram. And I notice that my little image, speaking of Eraserhead, he's everywhere. I share a birthday with Jack Nance, so it's like a spiritual thing. Anyway, you know when you have an Instagram story you've posted, but you haven't looked at it yet, there's a circle around it? There was a circle around my image. And I was like, that's weird, because I hadn't posted anything all night because I was talking to my friend and then freaked out by this ghost. I open it up, a black image shows up. There's no image. It's just pure darkness, just the color black. And I look at the timestamp. It was from when the lamp, the paraffin lamp popped off. So that was Halloween night. And that was the most incredible. I mean, I witnessed it. My friend witnessed it. It was a physical, something moved this thing physically. Yes, hold my beer, indeed. So that was crazy. In many ways, that was even more wild than the UFO I saw last Monday. But that was weird, too. And we can get into that. But that's my biggest ghost story to date. And I've experienced little things off and on my whole life.
I think that most people, like, at least it seems like most people expect to have a ghost story that's like, and then I saw this figure move through the room and it handed me something. It's much more subtle and weird than that. It has to do with like what you're thinking about and what you're talking about and the things around you and what things mean to you.
I agree.
Like it's very subtle.
Yeah. Your energy creates sort of the responses around you. And this was interesting because it was physical, but I do think it was because we were both thinking about it. There's Toad. Hello, Toad. What a great dog. Like, I love it.
Freaking out by my leg. I don't know if he got spooked. I don't know what's going on. Weird.
Context is king. And
that's why it's so hard to study, because people want a controlled environment, reproduce it, falsify it, but it like doesn't work like that. That's part of the wonder of it.
What's interesting about that Enfield poltergeist thing I was talking about in Apple is that this guy was like an inventor. But they have like people from the BBC, all these reporters in the house filming and audio while all this stuff is happening. It'd be very hard to, but this guy was like, I want to attack this with only science. Back then, of course, now we have all this shit that, you know, you all professionals use, but like, he's trying to just debunk this with science, and he's just like unable to, you know, and he's so accepting of it that it's not science. It's like it must be something else. It's either that she's creating this energy from her being, from herself outward, or there is something else in the in the house. But it's like that is just stuff like that I just love.
Yeah, what's interesting to me, so like back in the like late 1800s and the early 1900s, there was this group called the Society for Psychical Research.
And Harry Price, right? He was a part of that. Part of
And there was this guy who put together these two guys put together a book called Phantasms of the Living. It's a two-volume set. Each book is like 700 pages. And what they said is, we can't really seem to study this with science. So what we'll do is we'll collect as many stories as we can, and we'll look for similarities between the stories. They published this book in like 1902. Basically, at the end of the book, it says like, okay, so now we know this phenomenon is real. Like, we've proved it through interviewing 6,000 unrelated people about their stories.
Yeah.
And, oh, there's people coming in all over the place. We have guests all over, Jess. But anyway, well, check out Phantasms of the Living. Who's coming in? Huh?
Oh, shit.
Darcy's coming in. And Liam's coming in. Everybody's coming in at the same time.
Hey, everybody.
More the merrier.
Very popular time to enter.
Oh my gosh.
Nothing like 3:46, you know.
Liam, Tenny's only been talking about you to me for like 5 years.
Well, Tenny and I are attached by some kind of invisible quantum entanglement that I can believe it because I'm doing a video right now, and
I know you've only got scant seconds.
Like, I'm doing this video, and well, I'm at home. I mean, this is my green screen set. I'm on my phone because I don't have any computers that have built-in cameras. But so I'm doing this video, and I don't know, John, have you ever seen, I have a fake band, and I'm all three members of the band. I've released like three albums as this band called The Sweet Electric. It's like a T-Rex Bowie, like it's like a, it's just for fun, like a, it's just like super campy, like. And so I'm doing this video, and I'm trying to learn all these new programs that I've never used before. That so I've been like teaching myself these programs, and I'm making this video as a way. So I wrote this song, and it's called Never Human. And I've been thinking about you, John, the entire time I've been making this, and when I was writing it, because it's basically saying like, the way the world is right now, we're the aliens.
Right.
And everything, I'm like, and when I recorded the song, I was just like thinking about it. And so then yesterday I'm sitting there working on it. I'm like, and I thought of you, and I was like, Kenny would get every word of this song so hard. And then instantly, email from Tenny.
That's how it works between you and me.
I know. The last time was I rescued a cat, and and we had this kitten, and I'm like, and Robin was like, what are we gonna name it? And I'm like, we should name this cat John Tenny. And then
I don't know what happened.
Lost in the sauce.
Sorry.
Lost in the source.
Hang on. Wait.
There you are.
Wait. We lost you,
Liam. We lost you right as you said you were going to name
the room. The room to the left of me is my recording studio, and it's soundproof. And the walls, there's a metal. It's basically like a Faraday cage because there's metal strips going through all the walls to create an air gap between the drywall layers. And if I walk in there, it's just like my signal goes like that.
I will. But, I know you.
But I've been wanting to stop on the show for so long. I'm sorry.
It's all right. I'll tell later on our first in-person meeting, the story of that.
Okay. I just had the most freaky thing. Well, it's not freaky. It's just embarrassing. But John knows, I mean, your viewers don't know who I am or what that I do this, but I've been feeding a family of crows for 17 nice. Years.
Oh, wow.
That's and, awesome. And also a family of ravens that are four ravens. So they're always here at my house, and they're super, super smart. Like you can't
believe
they leave
you gifts and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
They know
they
who
bring
you are.
Me gifts. They bring me things. So I have a whole collection of all the things that the crows have brought me. And they're also like super aware of what's going on, by the way, the things that they leave you. They're like, they are super watching you. Anyways, we were just out. Robin photographs them and does big paintings of them. My wife, Robin. And
Liam, before you go any further, do you want to quickly give your credits quick?
Yeah, tell everybody how they know you, what you are known for.
I don't even know anymore because I'm a kind of all over the place person. In the 90s, I had my own TV show on MTV called Syphil and Ollie that were these.
Oh, shit. Puppets. I remember that. I didn't connect it. That's kid. Awesome.
So I created that and I did the voices and the puppeting and did that. Then I also had a song that was like a flash in the pan, funny song on the radio called United States of Whatever.
Love it.
And so I did that song. And then, I've done a lot. I wrote and directed a movie called Tenacious D and the Pick of Destiny.
Hell yeah.
And a bunch of other things. I've done a bunch of other, like, I've done three movies with Sarah Silverman, like stand-up specials, and I've done a bunch of things. And I do music videos for a lot of people. I've worked with Queens of the Stone Age for 25 years.
Wow.
And Tenacious awesome. D for over, I did a video for Tenacious D called, for a song called Tribute.
Oh, and, yeah.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
And then Jack and I have done a bunch of things. Like I wrote one of the songs, he and I wrote a song for like School of Rock, and we've done tons of things outside of Tenacious D. And now I do a lot of, I'm also a YouTuber, and I do music videos for all kinds of bands, from like, you know, Weird Al Yankovic to, you know, just did some bunch of stuff for Royal Blood and for all kinds of like
Weird Al was at my film premiere last month because he's friends with my lead actor Jonah Ray, and it was very exciting. Yeah,
Jonah, I met Jonah in the 90s before he had done anything, because he was in the Syphil and Ollie fan club, and we did one we did this thing for people, like a convention kind of, for like a gathering of people that had met online that liked the show, and it wasn't many people because the show wasn't very popular back then. but Jonah was there, and that's when I first met him.
That's awesome.
So I'm a kind of all over the place person. Like my career is almost like I'm being shot at and I'm trying to like run a zigzag.
Liam, what song did you write for School of Rock? It's become my kid's favorite movie.
Step Off.
Oh my gosh. Oh, that's so funny. They love that movie. We just showed it to them like 6 months ago, and they've watched it 6 times since then. They love it.
Oh, that's so cool. I've done music for TV shows and things that, you know, nobody would know that it's me. And then I also did all the music for a TV show called, that was an animated series a long time ago on MTV called Clone High. And then just got picked up again. And
there's a new season right now, right? On Max. That's so cool.
And
oh,
so
great.
They contacted me because they wanted to do a version of one of the songs I did in like the 90s or something. But
I love when all my weird friends like all my weird friends.
I know. Yeah. So,
this is very exciting.
But so anyways, these crows and the ravens, and I can't walk in there. I'll get disconnected. So I just went to the grocery store, and because I'm in LA, so it's a little earlier here. But not that you can't go to the grocery store in your time zone.
I think all four of you are on West Coast time.
Oh, yep. Really?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
LA, LA. Yeah.
Oh, sweet. Sweet.
Trader Joe's, by the way, to add my grocery experience to the.
Anyways, I just went to the grocery store and I get out of the car and one of the ravens followed me from my house.
What?
And that's so amazing. Like when I got out of my car, he came, and these are scary. When they're standing, they come up to your knee. They're like bigger than cats. They're monsters and they're really scary to be around. And but he came and he flew, and he has a certain clicking sound that he does, so I know that it was him. And it's like a very specific cadence. And he flew down and he landed here. So then I like took a picture of him and sent it to my wife. I'm like, oh, look who followed me at the grocery store. And one
Jessica's dream is to be followed by ravens and crows.
I know, why aren't I?
I the crows are just, they're like gang mentality. They're just a gang. Like they don't do something unless they all do something. But the ravens are really independent but the crows, I had two times, it was probably about 6 or 7 years ago, where I got in my car to go to the grocery store, and I went, it's the only place I go. And I went out the gate and the crows came down off the line, and I had a crow directly in front of my windshield at eye height, and then at my window, driver's or passenger side window at that window height, and one at my driver's side window, and they escorted me down the street, all the way down my street. I just said, it was like, you look weird, but it was really cool. I wish it would happen again, but they're not very consistent. Like they'll leave you stuff every day for a month and then not leave you anything for 2 years.
Which are the ones that rip the shit out of my yard? The crows or the ravens?
That do what?
Rip the shit out of my yard. Like you'll see, they'll go digging in yards. These giant black. I don't know.
Yeah, ravens could do that, but it sounds like skunks at nighttime.
Ah, okay.
Do you ever seen skunks over there, Eric?
No, I haven't. But we have this woman down the street who puts pails of seeds or something out for the crows or the ravens. I honestly don't know how you tell.
Well, what could be happening is that squirrels are taking the seeds and they're burying them in your yard. And then the crows are watching where squirrels bury them. And then the crows are going and stealing them later.
So I have two animals to deal with.
Wow. I love that this turned into animal talk.
I know.
The crows got smart from stealing.
Yeah.
From each other and other animals. And but ravens are on a whole other level, because ravens will fly around in forests and they'll find a deer, and then they'll fly and they'll find wolves, and they'll land, and the wolves know. The raven will tell the wolves to follow them, and the wolves will follow them through the woods to the deer and hunt it and kill it. And the raven just sits and waits for them to kill it and eat, and then it gets all the leftovers. So wolves and ravens have worked together for, you know, hundreds of thousands of years, probably.
Amazing.
Of hunting, of like ravens, like hunt, finding prey for the wolves and coming to get the wolves, like, hey, I know where there's some shit.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy. But I've wanted to call in, and one of the things is that I don't have a computer with a camera on, so I have to use my phone, which might be irritating. I'm sorry, but
that's fine.
No.
It's fine.
And we also, John, Robin and I finally went back to the Queen Mary.
Ooh.
First time since end of 2019, we hadn't been there. So we went and we bought our annual passes so that we can start going back. And the place was super active and super weird, like really intense energy. We saw things, like we got super intense orbs, not like dust, like you're looking and it's like something that comes from around the corner, does a straight line, makes a 90 degree turn, and you know. Huh. And I saw years ago, we were investigating there. We've been investigating there for, I don't know, 15 years.
You got married there, didn't you?
We got married there. Yeah. We got married in the.
Before you go any further, I just want to say Liam and I met online and we talked on emails. And then Amy Bruni booked A Strange Escape at the Queen Mary. And I went to the Queen Mary and I was like wandering the deck. And all of a sudden I heard a voice say, John Tenney? And I like look over and it was Liam. They were just there on a random trip to the Queen Mary.
We were just there investigating. We didn't
know. I was there investigating. And it was like this synchronistic moment of like, holy shit, we've been talking online. And then the forces of the universe just collided us on the deck of the Queen Mary.
It was so funny.
There are so many things that are connecting all of the people in this room. And I'm just sitting going like, is it that one? Is it that one? Is it that one? Because Liam, I have to say, Stipple and Ollie is still one of my favorite shows.
I quote it
all the time. I have fan art of Stipple and Ollie up in my home office, which is like amazing. And I am constantly trying to introduce new people to Stipple and Ollie all these years later.
I wonder if I have any Stipple and Ollie stuff in here. Do I?
I would lose my mind. I would lose my mind right now.
Tell us everything.
I don't. I don't know how to. I don't really know how to use this program. I'm just kind of on a website, I guess. Do I have any?
All of you have to come to an event.
I would love to exist in the real world. And
problem is, we don't live out there. We need to go out there again.
Yeah. Well, I think we make our own event on the Queen Mary because I was just back there the other night too. I wouldn't mind
going back east though. I'm originally from New Jersey and my parents are still out there. I don't think you're in Jersey.
Wait. I lived in Clifton for a while. Where did you live?
Holy shit. I grew up in Tenafly, New Jersey. So Bergen County, literally about 30 minutes from New York City. But I know Clifton pretty well. Yeah. Oh, small world.
Lots of spooky stuff there. Weird New Jersey.
I've been reading Weird New Jersey since the 90s, and back in my high school days, I wrote a poem about Weird New Jersey and living in it. I turned into a little video that was one of my earliest things on YouTube years later, and it was this close to getting in a special edition CD-ROM video collection that was going to be in a Weird New Jersey magazine, and then the funding didn't work out. But yeah, I love New Jersey. I go back all the time
from when I lived there. I still have like the original ones.
Nice. Yeah, that stuff, man. One of my best friends in high school, his family home is right next to the Devil's Tower in Alpine, New Jersey, and he'd be kept up at night by the teenagers driving their cars backwards around trying to summon the devil. Lovely stuff. Lovely.
I wanted to tell Liam too, if you haven't seen Charlie's movie yet, he recently made a movie for Shudder called Destroy All Neighbors, and I consider it like a companion piece to fucking Pick of Destiny.
Yeah,
so if you haven't seen it,
I think you'd like it, Liam. It stars Jonah Ray. He plays a struggling would-be prog rock.
I saw Jonah and I follow each other. I saw him advertising it on his Instagram.
It's really fun. We just had a sold-out screening at Vidiot's in Eagle Rock last night. Pretty much him fighting Alex Winter in full prosthetics, unrecognizable character makeup.
I saw that on his there. I saw a thing. I saw he was posting stuff on his Instagram.
What's it called again?
It's called Destroy All Neighbors. It came out on Shudder last month, and now it's available to rent through, I think, all VOD platforms. And then later this year, there will be a Blu-ray release and a limited edition vinyl of the soundtrack by the guys from Man
great.
Man, which
is
so exciting.
Awesome.
Cool.
Wait a second. Is Darcy, you're not from the East Coast, though, are you?
I am not from the East Coast.
You're the only one because Liam
only
and Eric,
non-East
you're
Coaster.
You're Midwest, aren't you?
I'm from Ohio originally.
Well, me too.
The second largest egg producing state. Liam, really?
Yeah, I was born and raised in Akron, Ohio.
Oh, Cincinnati.
Home of Devo.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
And Chrissy Hines. I do have one Stipple and Ollie thing, which it's a very deep cut, and it's, I think, only like in one or two episodes, but it's him.
Oh my God.
I'm so excited right now. Like, my whole day has been made. I'm just like, great, this is fantastic.
Incredible. There's not a day that goes by where Lucky Ladybug isn't stuck in my head, just so, like, just for the record. Yeah.
Well, and the other connection more connections, Jonah is in your movie, Charlie, which is fantastic. Mm-hmm. And Liam, you know Jonah from back in the day. And I know Jonah from slightly further back in the day from Comedy Death Ray at M-Bar. Many years ago.
Death Ray, I remember. Oh,
yeah, so it's all coming full circle. I'm excited about the convention the six of us are going to put on. This is going to be amazing.
Yeah, hell yeah.
We should.
Well, I just will pop on and say hello, and I will come back again now that I know how to do it and that I can use my phone. But and John, thank you for asking me and knowing that I'm your friend, even all the times that I couldn't join.
You're always my friend because you're my friend.
Yeah, you're my friend. I always have this weird feeling that John and I, in a past life, died together, and we were laughing.
That's cool.
John's like the best person ever to die with laughing.
I can confirm that 100%.
Like the very best person of something being so fucked up and terrible that all you can do is laugh until you die.
That's a new
I really love going out on that positive note.
That's a great one.
Yeah. But
thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Nice meeting you, Liam.
Meet everybody. Nice meeting you. And I will, I'll come on some again. Just let me know when you guys do it next time.
Yeah. Thank you, my friend. I love you.
All right. Love you too, man. See you guys.
Bye. Well, I have two more things to ask people who are on screen about before they, I don't know if y'all have to go, Charlie or Eric, who has to go first?
I have to leave at about 4:30, so I'm good for a little bit.
What about you?
For a little bit, my kids are watching television, so.
I don't know who to ask. Well, Eric, I want to ask about Nightcrawler because Nightcrawler has like cult status now. People are obsessed with that movie.
I'm interrupting your Nightcrawler thing.
What?
Because I just want to say the other what. Obviously, nobody likes talking about how do you know me? What have I done? Whatever.
I know it's a lot.
But I really wanted Liam to discuss was he was one of the first people in America to clone his pet.
I know we could have talked about that.
What?
He used the money from United States of whatever to clone his cat.
Yes. And I have my dog's DNA on ice in Texas in case I can ever have the money to clone my dog. And I really want to talk to him about it. And you talked to him about it before and he told me not to fucking do it.
Yeah, he said instead of spending the money to do it, you should spend the money to.
Damn it, you should have thought about it. We'll bring it up next time.
Okay, yeah. We'll bring it up next time. Cloned
dead, or does he now have two identical cats?
He had a cat. He had a cat that died.
Yeah.
And he saved its DNA and had it cloned.
Right there.
Well, no, mine is passed, and I have the DNA to bring it back. And then also, but to what you're saying, the company that I went through was the same company that Barbara Streisand went through, and I think the same company that Liam went through. But anyway, the creepy part is when Barbara Streisand did it, she did it when her dogs were still alive. So this new dog is born, and you're like, oh, you're like me, but you're little. That's messed up. I would only do it if the dog
was there. Liam said that the problem was when he brought the cloned kitten home, all the rest of his pets immediately recognized it as the other cat.
Yeah, yeah.
But this was a kitten that had no idea who those other animals
were. Wow. That's so complicated.
That's so weird.
He definitely has to talk about that next time. And I wanted to ask him about his crazy dream with you-know-who, and I couldn't ask because I didn't know if I was allowed to.
Oh, yeah.
But we'll talk about it next time.
We'll talk about it next time.
Okay, but anyway, back
he
to
has a great college. He has a great story about meeting the ghost of George Harrison.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah. Okay.
Seriously.
He was the best one. I think we can all agree on that emphatically. Because of his contributions to cinema with handmade films. Come on.
Right?
Yeah.
Let alone meditation and just being nice. Yeah.
Okay, back to Nightcrawler. Just anything you want to say, if there's anything. I don't know. I just know I'm obsessed with that movie. So many people. I feel like it goes around Twitter all the time.
I don't have a lot. I didn't have the best night on that movie.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. And I don't like want to, you know, talk smack too much, but I didn't have a great experience on that movie. That being said, the movie itself is amazing.
Yep.
And it was cool to do a little thing with Jake, but, you know, There are other jobs that left us a better impression.
Got it.
Than that one. But I don't think I'm proud to be a part of it. It's just, you know.
Eric, I don't think I told you how much, or maybe I did when we were at Waverly Hills, but how much I loved Perry Mason.
Oh, Perry, yeah. Yeah, short-lived Perry Mason. I
so
have
good.
This is my, like, wall of crap from each show. I try to steal something from each show. So
of course.
I don't know if there's any Lost fans here, but
oh yeah, shit.
Yeah,
that's I'm Lost, and that's iconic. My Darth Vader can.
Whoa. Show us everything.
These are my glasses from Lost, which were mine anyway, but I kept them. And let me see what else I have.
I love show and tell.
This is a great show and tell.
This was in the house in Escape at Dannemora.
Oh my God! Oh my God! I remember that.
That's amazing.
God,
that's so good. Let's see.
Yeah, that's all I really have.
I like your like. I'm taking.
Oh.
Let's see. This is. I'm now okay. So here, I have to show this. This is person.
Oh, that just
oh,
that
yeah, person. Yeah, he's very familiar. Yeah. I think I know his name.
He's some guy.
Just a flex. Anyway. Just a mean flex. A small flex.
I just keep all this stuff. And then the poster in the middle, I was like, what do I put in the middle of my shrine for business? And this is how the career works. It's like, what's next? I don't know. Whoever pays you to go somewhere and do something.
How do you get a picture with somebody bigger than Spielberg?
That's kind of a fun, like he... I did this play and it got moved to Broadway and Blythe Danner was in it and Blythe is Steven is their she's their godmother, Steven Spielberg's kids.
Oh.
So he came to the play and I got to meet him and I gushed all over him and
can't imagine.
He was so sweet to me. He like put his hands around my hand and he cupped my hands. He was like, that was heartbreaking. And I just stared at him. I said, okay, I have to go now. And I pulled my hands out and I grabbed his hands. And I'm like, you are the reason I'm an actor. Like your movies are like, and we got to talk for like 15 minutes, blah, blah, blah. Comes out and Ben Stiller, who directed it, texts me one day. I'll never forget it because we were at Disneyland. And he said, I just got off the phone with Spielberg and he went on and on and on about you and the show. And so we have some very, I keep it there as a totem to what might be, but has not been. But that's awesome. This is like, when I'm not working, I just turn around and I go, well, I worked once. I worked on that, or, you know.
The closest I ever came, I was in Los Angeles back in the 90s visiting my uncle who had been estranged from my father. And my uncle was very wealthy. He was like he did high interest loans for high risk businesses. And we got there on a Friday and he told one of his people, like, get us a table at Spago. And the person was like, it's Friday night. It's 7 o'clock PM. There's no way we're going to get a table at Spago. And my uncle said, do it. And so we went to Spago. It's packed. It's like, there's no place to sit. My uncle walks in, demands to see Wolfgang Puck. Wolfgang comes out, hugs my uncle. They kiss, they commiserate for a couple minutes. And then there's this big table overlooking Los Angeles and there's only three people sitting at it. And so Wolfgang Puck is like, hold on a second, I'll move those people. So he gets up, goes to the table, puts his arms around their shoulders. They all laughed. The three of them stand up and leave, and Wolfgang waves us over. The three people that he moved from my hillbilly family were Katzenberg, Spielberg, and Geffen. They were having a DreamWorks meeting, and he moved them for the fucking hillbilly tennies.
Awesome. Oh my God. He was the nicest guy. Prior to that meeting, like 10 years earlier, I was in Brentwood having lunch where I never am. And Spielberg and all of his children, he has like many kids, I guess some he's adopted or whatever, were having lunch like two tables over. And the whole lunch, all I could do is just stare. And I was too afraid to approach. And I have this rule about not bothering people when they're eating. Like I would never go up to someone and especially with your family. But sure. When he left... his root beer bottle was still in front of his thing, and I took it.
I would do that.
You have some DNA. You could be the DNA. You could get him cloned later.
Cloning.
Harvey, This is how sick I am. On the way home, I'm holding the bottle. My wife is driving, and I'm holding it like this. And I went,
no!
Touched my tongue.
Brilliant.
Just Spielberg's DNA, hoping that it would somehow melt.
Anyway, yep, Eric is our people.
Yes, I'm a total nerd for all this stuff. Awesome. Anyway, yeah, I've had like great career in TVs and movies and theater and all of it, and I'm really lucky, you know. But it's all based in like what I loved about going to the events was meeting all the weirdos, because that's really what all of us are, directors, actors, writers, we're just people who make believe shit for a living, you know what I mean? And now we get to hang out with people and examine this stuff in a sort of a real world basis. Mm-hmm. It's the best.
And you can, and the thing that I always tell people is who's never been to any kind of event or convention or anything before, or investigation, bigger investigation, you can say anything and it's okay.
Yeah, there's no judgment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Problem. You walk past a group of people who are talking about fairy encounters, and you can tell them your Bigfoot encounter, and someone who had a UFO encounter will talk about their and it's all fine. Everybody's like, oh, yeah.
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 Remember that kid at the last one? We were sitting outside, and he started talking about the fact that he was gay, and do you remember that kid? And he started
He was trans and had never been able to be open about it.
That's what it was. And I was like, oh my God, we're all just sitting on this step here listening to this kid's story, and he's like tearing up. I have such like love for the people in this community, you know. Mm-hmm. And I don't know many of them that well, but that's mm-hmm. why I'm here, you know. So
yeah, it was amazing moment.
Yeah, yeah.
Wait, I have a Spielberg story too. I know it doesn't seem like I should, but I do have one.
We got to get him on next week.
I know. No, it was, I don't know how many years ago, but John Williams conducted the Detroit Symphony Orchestra and did a sampling of all his fucking songs. And it was like a special night, like only symphony members could buy the tickets, and my friend was a symphony member and she brought me with her, and in between all of John Williams conducting, Steven Spielberg came out in between every song and talked about all of his movies, and it was like best night of my whole life.
That's amazing.
I know, it was like not even real.
I don't have a Steven Spielberg story, but I know what John Williams' middle name is.
What is
it's it? Towner.
I did not know that.
John Towner Williams.
I love that. He's so.
Jessica consistently tells me like that John Williams created like our lives by his music.
Yeah.
I mean,
my age group, for sure. You know?
I'm like, John Williams shaped my whole life.
Son has started watching. He's about to be six, but he's gotten interested in Back to the Future and Raiders of the Lost Ark and Star Wars. I wonder why, you know.
Mm.
And he through those things knows who John Williams is. Mm. So I came home the other day and he's just watching a YouTube video of John Williams conducting an orchestra.
Amazing.
You're a great, that's great parent done. That's
I think I'm doing it right. I think he should
that's
be
a wrap.
Yeah, John is amazing. He lives in Brentwood. And there's this video of this kid showing up to his house.
Yes.
Standing outside playing Raiders on the trumpet or something.
Aww.
And the neighbors must have been like, God damn it.
But John Williams comes out and talks to the kid.
Yeah. It's so like this Spielberg and all John and all those things. It's like when these people that you have this godlike admiration of turn out to be just normal, lovely human beings.
Yes.
Your brain kind of explodes, but... Yep. But that's what it should be, right? You know.
I mean, to speak to that briefly, I kind of felt that way working with Alex Winter on Destroy All Neighbors, because he was a big part of why I'm into this stuff. Seeing Freaked back in the 90s, like that was it. I love Bill and Ted, but Freaked, and the fact that I ended up writing something that got him involved, and he's just lovely. And yeah, having him talk to me, just chill, down to earth, but in pure prosthetics, looking angry as hell, it was wild.
Wow.
So. Yeah, it's amazing.
Do you guys want to hear, because I have to go in like 10 minutes. Do you want to hear the ghost story in my house that started all of this?
Of course.
Yes.
John, I think you've heard it.
You told me, but go ahead.
I haven't heard it.
I'll make it shortish. But I had this 1950s house, my first house in LA. And I had a girlfriend at the time. We were living together and we broke up and she moved out, and like, it was kind of a long process. They were like, come home. There were just like boxes in the house of stuff. And it was very heavy, you know? It was just a heavy period. And my friend came over once. He said, when you turn on the lights to your house, it feels like a bunch of people were whispering and suddenly stopped. Ooh. You know, and I was like, really? And he's like, there's a vibe. And I was like, okay. But because it was so heavy with breakup energy, I'm like, well, of course, that's probably it. Well, like 6 months go by, we hadn't talked, and we have our first conversation on the phone. And we're talking, and all of a sudden I hear boom, 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 in another part of the house. And I literally ran into the hallway like someone just broke into my house. And there's nothing, but I see this painting that I've had leaning against the dresser for the 4 years I'd lived in the house on the floor. This is LA, there's earthquakes and whatever. It's never moved, it's on the floor. And I just said, I have to call you back. And I hung up and I walked into the room, and it's the first and only time really I felt like those major O chills when you're like, I just walked into an electric vortex. Yep. And the painting is on the ground. And at that point I had been watching enough of you nut jobs hunt ghosts. I'm like, oh fuck, I brought it to myself. I brought it to my home. And then my next instinct was, I can't acknowledge that this could happen in my house. So I went out loud, oh, that's so funny. It must have just fallen. Like, because I didn't want my thoughts to be recognizable to the entities in my house.
Yeah, don't be scared. Don't act scared.
Yeah, and I just picked up the painting and I put it on the ground. And I was like, you know, I do have the back door open sometimes. Maybe a squirrel came through the house, jumped up, and when the painting fell, it hid. So maybe it's under the bed. So I look under the bed and there's this like glowing green light behind the stand that held my TV. What? And now I'm just fucking.
What?
Yeah, now I'm terrified. So I go over there, but it's not the light you think it is. It's the DVR that had sat on my TV for years, has gone off the TV into the wall, dented the drywall, and flipped over on its back, and the green light is this power light.
Wow.
And or it was a glowing squirrel.
And I know, yeah, or it was a really strong squirrel. But I am genuinely terrified now, because that's heavy. And I had it sitting, it was back when we had tube TVs, but like the feet of the DVR are over the front edge of the TV, so it can't go back, you know? So I'm like, maybe it was the cord. It goes under the house and an animal pulled the cord. Well, DirecTV had locked that little cord into some sort of a cylinder that kept it from moving.
Yeah.
I checked earthquakes. I mean, I was, you know, so I called my ex back and I was like, this just happened. And I'm like shaking. And she goes, come over. Mm-hmm. So I did. And we ended up briefly getting back together. And I always had this weird feeling that we had a pool in the back at that house. And I had this, it was from the 50s, right? When you didn't have pool protection. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I always had this weird feeling that there was a kid, that it was a kid. It was at the height that a kid would have reached. And I had this weird belief that we broke up and the kid was upset. Wow. And the kid was like, he's on the phone with her. Do something now. It'll scare him out of the house and they'll get back together.
Dang.
And that is exactly weirdly what happened. And then we broke up again and I had a buddy over and I'm telling him the story about the DVR and I'm like, look at that. Try and get that thing to move off the TV. And he says, so weird. And I said, yeah, it was a few months ago, but it hasn't happened since, thankfully. And we went to lunch and I came home and the fucking DVR is on the floor again.
Wow.
I kid you not. And then the weird thing that would happen was at night, I would feel something cupping my toes.
Ew, no.
Top of the thing. And again, I thought, this is at the height, right, of a kid. I just always had this. So I woke up once, and this was kind of I was getting afraid to go to sleep this, I don't drink anymore, but this was back when I drank. So I'd have like so many drinks to go into that room to go to bed. But I did wake up once, like half dream, half awake. And I saw this like 12-year-old kid standing in the bedroom, like looking out the window toward the pool. And then he disappeared. But that's like real. A full human boy.
That's real.
And I thought maybe that's who it's been this entire time. But I got so tired of the lack of sleep and living in fear of going to bed. That one night, after my many drinks, I'm laying in there. And I got so fucking tired of it. I marched into the living room in my underwear with the lights off, you know, half buzzed from some drinks. And I was like, I'm over it. I'm done. I cannot do this. It is not your house. I don't give a fuck if you're okay. You know, I was just furious.
That's how you do it.
And I walked back in the bedroom and I slammed the door and I rolled over and I went to sleep and nothing ever happened again.
There you go. That's how you do it.
5 minutes.
You have to take that ownership. I've done that before because I think my house is haunted. I've interacted with ghosts before. I don't really give a shit when they're fucking with me, but when they fuck with my pets, then I get pissed off. And then you have that talk that you just had. It's like, I don't care if you're here. You need to go to the attic. You need to go to the basement. You need to go somewhere where you're not scaring the pets because it's not okay. And then it'll like die down for a while. You have to like set those boundaries.
Yeah, it was a very weird like chain of events, and the relationship that was intermingled into it was weird. And but that got me on board, like, okay, well, if it's gonna be in my house, I wanna understand this shit better, you know. Anyway, ever take your house back. That's right. That's right. Look at these comments. I should be trying to read these too. Are you guys reading these?
A little bit.
By the ghost of Flubber.
Katie.
A fetish ghost. Yeah.
Tarantino ghost. Yeah.
Total Tarantino ghost.
Mm-hmm. You know it.
Jess knows because I've said this at lectures before. What? Like I did a lecture at a comic book shop and there was a little kid there and he was maybe like 7. And he said he had a ghost in his house. He had never told his parents. And I said, well, where's the ghost? And he said, it's under my bed and it's also in my closet. And I said, does that scare you? And he said, yeah. And I said to him, like, it's reframing, right? And it's a lot of it has to do with our mental attitude. And so I said to him, if you were in a house and you weren't supposed to be there, where would you hide?
Right, right.
And he said, in the closet. And I said, or under the bed, or in the basement, or in the attic. A lot of times I think they know they're not supposed to be in there. And so they literally are trying to stay away from us, which makes them, to us, seem even more scary.
Yeah.
Wow.
I remember you telling me that. I this thing just felt so. And you know, those old DVRs, those things were like, had some weight to them.
That's wild.
I mean, they were a little bit sentient because then they would be like, hey, did you want to watch this? And you're like, I never wanted to watch. Yeah. Why would you choose that for me? And it's I recorded 17 hours of it. Don't you want that?
No. I have a season pass on the Bachelor now? I don't understand.
I have to head out right now. This was wonderful. Great to meet
Charlie.
You all.
Invite me back so later.
Wait, I want to hear your UFO story.
I'll put the link to the footage there. There's a YouTube link. I saw a cigar-shaped UFO above my neighborhood on Monday. Got a little bit of footage. It's weird. More news at 11, so to say. Thanks for the invite.
On your Instagram.
Mm-hmm. I'll see you all later. Have a good night.
Nice to meet you, Charlie.
Bye.
How often do you do this? You've mentioned it to me before, but
every 6 months or something.
No,
like
not 6 months, like every 2 or 3.
Oh, you got to do this more because I want to come back.
Well, you can.
I'm lonely. Clearly.
Our next one is in April. You're more than invited.
Okay, I'll come. Tenny, you're out of focus.
That's all the weird colored lights and stuff in my.
Oh, the camera's confused. Okay. Just looking out for this. You know what I mean?
I know. Oh, trust me. It's all gone.
Eric, we can invite you to some weirdo West Coast hangs. Like, I know they're far out there, but we'll figure it out.
Please do.
I know, Darcy, you still have to explain your ghost. Darcy hosts, or what is the word?
Yeah, I'm a ghost host. I'm the ghost host.
Yes.
So I lead haunted historical tours at the Kellogg House in Santa Ana, California.
Oh, wow.
And I was just there last night for Leap Day because I was like, why not have a ghost tour on a liminal day that we only have every 4 days? So it's one of the things I do. I also work at a university. I'm currently in my office at Cal State Fullerton right now. But yeah, so I tell people, like, I get paid to talk to people about local history and then tell ghost stories about the Kellogg family, not of cereal fame, but of gardening fame. And there's been a lot of really interesting stuff as of late that, like, I haven't even talked to anybody about. If y'all want to hear some inside hot Victorian ghost gossip that's been happening lately.
Shit.
So the man that built the house, Hiram Kellogg, was married once before his wife, Helen, who we talk about on the tour a lot. His wife, Victoria, passed away from complications of childbirth, like weeks afterwards. Not uncommon for the time, but she was like the love of Hiram's life. And like her monument, super beautiful. And it's so clear that he loved her desperately. And his second wife, Helen, was more known as a marriage of convenience. Because, you know, that's how you want your marriage described to people. Tons of decades later. So the first thing I noticed when I ever came to like tour the house when we were getting ready to put everything together was that Victoria has very dark hair and very strong eyebrows. And I was like, oh, this woman looks a lot like me and my family. Like it was very like, oh, okay. And so I was like, we'll see if Helen is fine with me. Cause we think that Helen is still in the house. She passed away in the house. She outlived two husbands. Like this is very much Helen's house. So I was recently there with the Golden State Paranormal team, who are really lovely people, very much our weirdo fam, inclusive, welcoming, trying to do it right. And they invited me to come and investigate with them. Like I didn't have to work, which was nice. And so we were in the office and I had been feeling like something had been like standing behind me with like hands on my shoulders, not like gripping me, but just kind of standing behind me, adult size. And I thought at first, it was Helen. I was like, oh, maybe Helen's in here because Helen died in that room because she turned it from an office to a bedroom later. And then, you know, we're asking questions. We're going back with like burst EVPs really quickly. And it's not Helen that's showing up. So I'm like, hey, can we do another EVP session, Martin? He's like, sure. And so I was like, Hiram, are you here? We get a yes. I said, Hiram, are you here because I remind you of Victoria? Yes.
Nah.
Mm. Hiram, do you think I'm the reincarnation of Victoria? Yes, I know. Okay.
That's why you were there.
And then I was like, Hiram, are you the one? Because I'd been in another room and I'd felt really sad all of a sudden. I was like, this isn't my sadness. Like somebody's sad. And I said, Hiram, are you the one that's really sad right now? Yes. And then I asked because where the Kelloggs are interred. So Victoria's buried and Hiram is in the community mausoleum. They're in the same cemetery. And Hiram is interred right next to Helen. And I asked Hiram, would you rather be buried next to Victoria than in the mausoleum with Helen? And he said, yes, I would. And I was like, we finished that and I had to take a break. I had to go take a walk because I became so emotional. Dang. And like being in this space where suddenly like I've already been having to navigate like Helen, who sometimes like gets mad at things getting changed in the house or if we're not telling the right stories about her, she shows up and like does stuff in the house to now like this weird like Elizabeta, like Count Dracula kind of like here I am. And like, and then the fact that he doesn't seem to have been able to find Victoria wherever he is, like it's just been real. It's been a time lately.
Wow, so, man.
Yeah.
That is intense.
It's really, really intense. And like, you know, Pate friends, it's one thing to talk about it, but like, I asked them like, hey, if you post something about this, like, don't like, let's keep that out because like the Kellogg family is still involved with the house. So I don't need them being like home wrecking ghost tour. Like,
they're not the Darcy. They're not the Kelloggs from Michigan, are they? Do you know that? Because we have like Kellogg's cereal is from Battle Creek. Is from Battle Creek, Michigan.
Not Kellogg's cereal.
Okay.
So
ours, our Kellogg's are the Kellogg cereal. Kellogg's.
Yeah. We have another house like kind of up the road in Pomona that is Kellogg cereal. And I joke on my tours. I'm like, they had a whole nother feeling about how people should live in like bland cereal and anti-sex and all that.
Yeah, anti-sex and eat a lot of grain.
Yeah, because nothing makes you feel sexier than a lot of grain.
Nothing makes you feel sexier than being completely unbound in your body.
Right? Are you feeling unbound today?
Amy D says she was there when I had the ball experience at Waverly. Hi, Amy. That was so mind-blowing. Sorry, I just...
No, that is good.
That is an intense, crazy story. So Santa Ana.
So Eric, where do you live? I live in Tustin, Old Town Tustin, so just nearby. And I'm in LA all the time. So,
get together, let me know. Because and you, or you got to get back out here again, John.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, we were supposed to get when Jess and I came out.
Yeah, I wanted to go to Queen Mary. It
didn't work out. Yeah. No.
That was a whirlwind of a trip.
Yeah, it was a whirlwind of a trip. By the time we got there, here's the thing. Because I flew to LA.
Yeah.
But Jess had been on the road for, I think, like 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
How long were you on the road by the time I got to LA?
Like 2 weeks.
Yeah, 2 weeks.
Living
so she
out
was
of my
over
car.
It by the time I got there.
Yeah. And then we spent like 5 days in LA and then we drove back through like everywhere, Arizona,
New
Mexico, went to Roswell.
She had never been to Roswell. I took her to Roswell.
I'm using my Roswell glass that we got there right now. Ready?
Nice.
Look at that. I was just texting with Amy too, Bruni.
Yeah,
I told her I was doing this, and she's like, "Oh, tell them I said hi."
I asked her to be on here, but Charlotte has a play tonight, and she couldn't do it.
That's what she told me. Aww. I was just texting her about that weird documentary thing I was watching. I was so that Enfield Poltergeist thing.
Yeah,
yeah. That's a great story.
Back to that. There's so many corny, badly produced paranormal docs. That doc is stunning. The work that they did on that, it's gorgeous.
It looks like a real level true crime doc, but about ghosts, which I just don't see.
By the way, let me just talk about some offense that just happened.
What?
Uh-oh.
I am offended.
What?
But you were interested in some ghost stuff, Eric Lang. You have my phone number. And you're texting Bruni about it?
Because I was going to see you today.
Get the fuck out of here.
Is it because you know Amy will text you back, Eric?
Give me 30 seconds. I've been with you an hour and 7 minutes.
I appreciate all of it. I really do.
Hang on,
Jess, I'm glad you caught that.
I did.
All right, guys. I got to go. I got to go help father my children. But thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Darcy and Jessica, it's lovely to meet you.
So nice to meet you.
Keep me in all the loops, man. John, I miss you, brother. I miss you.
I miss you, too.
We'll come hang out with you.
Yeah, and everybody in the chat, man, thanks for all the chit-chat. And I'm sorry I didn't see more of it. But try and I love you, too, Melissa. just thanks. This was so much fun for me.
Yay.
Thank you.
Thank you
You're
for
welcome
coming,
anytime.
Eric.
All right. We'll see you soon.
Okay, bye.
Leave studio.
He's so wonderful.
This show is so fun.
I'm just so pleased. Like, I'm just like, great. I'll just sit here.
I know my face hurts from smiling so much. I don't even see people this much.
This has been great.
I can't believe that I haven't really had to talk to Jessica for like an hour.
Not this whole time, I know.
That's the most exciting thing for me.
Wow, Tenny. Wow.
She knows.
I know. We are our only friend in real life that we see all the time. So it's like we could use the break and talk to her.
I love one of my favorite things is when Jess knows that I haven't talked to her in a while and she knows I want to talk to her. So I'll get a text message that says, "Don't call me. I have a headache."
Yep.
Oh,
listen, cause we won't interact for like a day or two. And then I'll DM him something semi juicy. And I know the second he sees the DM, he's going to call me. So I'm like, don't call me because he doesn't text. he won't see an exciting thing and text you back. He will literally call you. And I'm like, I don't want to be on a call. Just fucking text me about the thing I just showed you. It's fine.
So, Jessica, I want to let you know that Jessica and I have been texting a little bit this week about trying to get somebody else here.
We were. It's a surprise, but hopefully they come on a future one.
I slyly kind of mentioned it because some scheduling changes had happened.
Oh.
And they were like, oh, I'm not able to. And I was like, that's okay. But I kind of was like, hey, if you're craving to be on a podcast today. So I tried.
I love that. I feel like it'll happen in the future. It's just like, this came up really fast. I don't know why or how.
This did come up really fast. And you know what? I am shocked that Liam showed up.
Me too.
That was,
he was in the waiting room when you were gone. And I'm like, do I let him in? I don't even fucking know him.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
I know we've never met before, but it's great to have you here. Hello, Tenny's friend.
This is the realest comment of the night, actually.
Oh, yeah. Right?
Oh, Eric is a much better looking me.
I feel like you guys do look like brothers, maybe. Everybody's having the best time. I was so excited to talk about Syphil and Ollie, first of all.
I used to be obsessed
with that show.
I am still obsessed with that show. Like, I quote it all the time and people are like, what? And I was
when I first met Liam on the Queen Mary, we had been talking, emailing about ghost stuff
for
probably a year. And he had never mentioned anything about what he did for a living. He's just a guy emailing me about ghost stuff. Mm-hmm. And so when we met on the Queen Mary, we were sitting in the bar and I was having a drink and I said, what do you do for a living? And he did the exact same thing he did tonight where he was like, I did this show on MTV called Syphil and Ollie. I was like, I know what that show is. And he was like, and I wrote the song called United States or whatever. And I was like, I know that. And he's like, and I wrote and directed Pick of Destiny with
Destiny.
I'm like,
people to this day don't say whatever, right? They say whatever,
whatever.
Yeah.
They do the thing.
Like,
yeah.
And then like the first thing, like I went home and like YouTubed like his name, and Lynchland is his YouTube channel. If anybody wants to check it
out. So good.
But the first clip was some clip of him doing Pick of Destiny and he's standing next to Ronnie James Dio. And I was like, why is this guy talking to me?
I was this exact comment. I was thinking it's such a like thing that creatives do, and me and Tenny both do it. It's like, oh yeah, I did this thing, and you know, I don't really want to talk about it because you feel like embarrassed by your own fucking success.
Yeah.
Like, let's talk about somebody else. We don't have to mention what I did, but
yeah.
But it's one of those things though where like I think that's part of the reason why we're friends, right? Because if you had been talking to Liam and he had been like, do not.
Yeah, you guys know.
Excuse me. Hi. You've not seen that my creative genius hurt. Like, you would have just been like, who's this guy, right?
Then there was there was a moment, I think it was through email. We were chitting and chatting back and forth through email. And he said something like, I'm working on a new, like, just, it's Liam. So he is just who he is, which is very beautiful and why I love him. And he said something to the effect of like, hey, so just so you know, I'm working on Morrissey's new album and Morrissey knows who you are. And I was like, what? And he goes, yeah, Morrissey watches all the ghost shows. And so I had mentioned you and he knew who you were and he watches like Ghost Hunters. And I was like, what is happening?
Crazy.
That's so amazing. Do you want to hear a good Morrissey story?
If there is one.
Better than Morrissey knowing who you are. I mean, like, that's pretty amazing. So my friend Jesse used to work at this restaurant in LA called Amalfi, Italian restaurant. Whenever Morrissey was in town, he would go to Amalfi. And Jesse is like super crazy Morrissey, like, so, but would have to be like, keep it cool. You're going to go serve Moss. Like, it's good. And Morrissey, I love the story because it's the most Morrissey thing ever. Jesse goes over to him. Before Morrissey was full vegan, and he's like, would you like some more cheese on your pasta? And he's like, sadly, yes. Jesse just
no
putting cheese on the pasta.
So
when ever anybody is like, like, would you like more cheese? I'm like, sadly, yes.
So to that, Darcy, this plays perfectly. So I freaked out when Liam sent me that email saying that Morrissey knew who I was and watched ghost hunting shows. And I sent him an email back and I said to Liam, I said, is Morrissey really like that? Like, I've had an idea of Morrissey my whole life. Is he really like that? And Liam's response was, I produced a song for him, sent him the mix, and Morrissey's response in the email was, this song has killed me, and yet I still live.
I'm just not saying that when we're at restaurants and you're gonna be like, how's your food? I'm gonna be like, the food has killed me, but yet I still live. I'm gonna say that at Olive Garden. Oh,
that is so, so amazing.
I
because
love it.
He is Morrissey all the time. He is Morrissey all the time. I wasn't Morrissey for a long time and then went to a show and then was like, oh, I get it now. And then he's like, who needs awards? I have all of you. And I was like, yep, I'm in. Yeah.
You're like,
Yeah, I saw that.
Got it.
Yes, bitch.
They were probably, the Smiths was probably like my sixth or seventh live show back in the 80s.
Amazing.
Like, because it was the Queen is Dead tour. So, like, they were the Smiths by that point, because Queen is Dead was a pretty big album. But I mean, they were still only playing a place. They were playing the Royal Oak Music Theater, which I think only holds 1,000 people or 1,500 people. So that was amazing.
That's like
Morrissey at Masonic Temple. I wonder if he saw any ghosties.
I mean, he's a ghost guy.
That's probably why he wanted to play there.
I mean, it works into, I mean, if you figure, like, it makes sense if you start to look at Morrissey's body of work, that he is hanging out in cemeteries, playing with Ouija boards. Like, he's a ghost person.
He's a ghost guy. He's a ghost guy for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. Speaking of which, how is your teenage self doing today after cemetery smoking time yesterday?
Let me tell you, walking through a cemetery, kicking leaves, listening to the Smiths, smoking cigarettes, it really did do something for, like, my self-esteem and my heart. Like, remembering who I used to be and doing the things that I did, even though, like, it was beautiful.
Which, were you in one of the two Royal Oak cemeteries that are nearby?
Yeah, there's a Pie Wedge Cemetery in Royal Oak.
The Pie Wedge Cemetery, I hit that up before I came home.
Yeah, that's like my favorite.
That one is close to our heart.
The one I used to hide in when I was in high school.
That's amazing.
Wait, Darcy, you have to tell everybody also you have had a TED Talk before, and I feel like you're the only person I know who has had their own TED Talk.
Wait, I'll be back in a second. No.
Okay.
Jenny's like, I don't want to hear that talk. So yeah, I don't know about everyone in the chat, like, weirdo fam. I, huge surprise, I'm extroverted. I know, everyone's so shocked. But during lockdown was rough for me. Like, I was not doing good in lockdown because I love connecting with people so much. And wanting, you know, like, what do I do? Like, I need to do something. And so I had seen a few other people that I'm connected with who did do TED and TEDx. And I was like, oh, I'm just going to make that a goal. Like, suddenly I'm like, I'm just going to do a TED talk when the next time that opportunity that comes up all the time. And so we have a TEDx affiliate here at the university. And so the next application process that came around, I submitted a couple different ideas and they interviewed me and I had to kind of give them a rough outline of everything. And then they said, well, you know, your talk, like, we like your ideas, but we really like the work that you're doing around death, grief, and the college student. So would you like to do that? I was like, yeah, sure. Okay. Oh, thank you so much, CJ. Thank you so much. And so from there, I had to then go, like, TED is a real involved thing, right? Like, even though I'm on the, like, inside being here, it was still level after level. And so I went and I wrote a rough draft and then I came back for, like, a second round of auditions. And then they're like, okay, you're in. And I was like, oh my God, like, oh my gosh, like I'm going to be giving it like a TEDx talk. And so continuing to work it and craft it. And like, this is how nerdy I am, as I previewed it for my D&D group. And I was like, how are we feeling about this? And they were like, oh, they gave me some good pointers that helped me like to, you know, turn things around a little bit. But that day it was like the TED letters showed up like on the stage. And I was like, those are the, like, those are the letters. Like, I'm going to go. So there's a picture of me like, hi, seeing the TED letters. And it was really, really incredible. And I think, and I'm one of those people that I'll write and memorize things like Tenny. I tend to talk, like, I just, you know, like, oh, I'm going to talk on a topic and here's, you know, this is what we're talking about. But TED was so rehearsed and so memorized. And then once I was done with it, it immediately left my brain. It was just like, boop, we're done. But I really felt like everything was on my side that day because people had been having issues with the wireless mics cutting in and out. And so there was like, oh, just be aware, your mic might cut out all the stuff. My mic never cut out. Everything went just, it was God in the universe, whatever you want to call it, like, was just with me that day. And I had like visualized what I was going to wear and how I was getting, like, I went through all these spaces of like, okay, I'm going to find this type of dress and I'm going to look at these kind of way, like, and it was so powerful to get that honor, right? Because like, there are people they say no to. And I think it's one of those things where, and I've been talking with people about this a lot, is the amount of work that it requires to make things look easy. Because I can remember that another, some very good friends of mine have another friend who is taking like a class on like how to get your own TED talk. Oh, hello, Tobin. He's like, me. I was giving my own TED talk.
Let me just mute myself. I don't know how to hang on.
Real quickly, Darce, years ago, I had the opportunity to do a TEDx in Detroit. And it seemed to be going well until we got to the point where they were like, okay, so there was this, I don't remember much about the situation. It wasn't that long, but there was like this conversation about like, you have 15 minutes, like we do go by the second, like, and I was like, oh, I can't do this. Like, I can't do it.
Yeah, because when I write out, like, if I write out a speech, I have to trim. I always overwrite. Like, even when I'm writing papers or conference stuff, like, I always have these files that'll say, like, you know, death and grave, you know, paper extras. Like, because I just have chunks and chunks of stuff that's extra. And so it was really about trimming that down and working. Like, they gave me a team to work with. That were like, okay, we've got to trim here and trim here. But yeah, it, I feel you on that. Cause I was like,
yeah, because like, I know you're like me and there's a part of me that wants to say like, and so when you're using a pendulum, which was made, and then like, I want a side note and I want to say like, which is made most popular by the power of the pendulum by that was written, you know, by this person in 1963 and you should read T.T. Lethbridge, but don't read Ghost and Ghoul. Don't read Power of the Pendulum. Like, and already I'm completely can't do it.
And it's so hard. And I find that whenever I'm asked to like short talks, people will be like, oh, recently someone's like, we're going to have you come speak on like racism and anti-racism. I was like, I'm going to need some parameters because like that is like a, that's a big thing, right? Like we're going to talk about all these things and I'm the same way. I totally want a side tangent. I want to give you every, I am both the text and the footnote. Talk, right? And so
well, you've gotta give, that's the thing though, right? Like you've got to give people the credit for the idea that you have. Right.
And I think so. I mean, and you know, we've talked about it before too, like with, even with jokes, like, oh, this is, you know, so-and-so's thing or like, and I think it's one of the things that is so important in our weirdo world because we see it done really, really dangerously, right? And I've talked about this on some other pods before about going to see one of the big conspiracy people, but say, you know, oh, I can't remember the citation, but you know what I mean.
Right.
And it's like, no. One, I want to know where it comes from. And two, you assume that Jess thinks the same thing that you do, that I like, you can't do that.
Right. And some people think you have blue blood inside of you.
I mean,
crab, Jess. Jess is a crab.
Listen, the thing about our podcast is I say things out loud that people also think, and then we both find out that we're wrong together and we all grow.
I'm going to tell you, I am listening.
An important situation and people's learning things.
I was listening to the new episode on the way to the museum last night, and listening, Tenny, to you say old slang very flatly was killing me.
Yes.
It was killing you so hard because you're like, and now it's just like it was
not ready for that either.
It was the most gentle but like old man thing to be like. So I looked up some of the things the young people have said.
What those youngsters were talking about back in the day. One of them I didn't bring up that I should have. I was listening when I was editing the podcast. I didn't bring up. Do people still say bogue?
Bogue, like bogus? I like bogue a lot.
There's somebody directly in front of the house. I don't know what to do about it. They're going to be gone in a second. Toad thin. Everybody's yelling at you. I wanted to bring up too. Oh my god.
This is your life, Jess, all day,
baby,
every day.
Baby, get this. Get that. All right, anyway. I was gonna link to Darcy's TED Talk under our episode. Listen, when this live is over, I will have everybody that we've had on social links under the episode, but I couldn't put them before because then it'll ruin the surprise.
Yes.
So just when it's over, if you want to find the socials of anybody that's been on here, go under the YouTube video and they'll be there.
Yeah. And you can, and people reach out to me, like y'all, many of you already, we're all connected, right? Like this is like a weirdo fam hang. So just reach out if you can't find it on there either. Like it's also one of those things where, and every part of the comedian in me, Tenny, by the way, at the end of my TED Talk wanted to be like, and thank you for coming to my TED Talk. I didn't do it. And I wanted to say to you face to face something that you had asked on the New Year's Eve marathon that you did. Because we were chatting and you go, Darce, can I call you Darce? Is that all right? Yes. And I couldn't put it in the chat because here's the stupid thing.
Well, no, what happened?
Uh-oh, mine's freezing too.
No, I'm here.
Stay here.
All right. Why is everybody
here?
Okay, I'm here.
I'm going to have to leave.
All right.
You're going to be by yourself then.
All righty. Are you guys still hearing me in the chat? Did they freeze and I'm fine? Listen, recently I got fiber internet. Is it called fiber? Whatever it's called. So it looks like I'm the only one with working internet. I hope. You guys, yep, still hear me? Okay. Are you, I hear both of you, just not Darcy. Okay, they hear me. Oh, our next guest is here. Why does this keep happening when I'm alone? Okay, Darcy's back. I gotta let, hang on, wait. How do I let you in? Add to the stage. Okay, Darcy's back. Listen, our other guest is back, and our other guest is here, and Tenny just got booted from the room.
All right, let's handle it. Let's do it.
You guys want to see who our next guest is all by ourselves without Tenny?
Let's do it.
Here we go.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Hi.
I think I jinxed everything.
No, listen, this is like the 30th time he's got booted from our fucking feed. So.
Oh, my gosh.
He's just not doing the things. So, apparently. or he's doing too much.
The chat is very excited. The chat is very excited.
Hey, everybody. Hey, how you doing? For those few people out there, know I am. Nice to see you tonight. I was going to say, the live stream has killed me, but yet I still live.
Yay! Yay! Yeah. You have the best background out of all of us.
Hey. Yeah, those fun jellyfish are amazing.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, John.
Special guest is.
Oh, my goodness gracious. What is happening?
I didn't tell him you were coming. That was a surprise.
How's it going?
That's amazing. Good. How are you?
Good. I just came because I wanted to see your socks.
Oh, I have boring socks on today. My Ritz Cracker socks were yesterday.
Missed moment.
No. Missed moment. I'm sorry.
No, it's good. It's good to be here. I don't think I've ever done a podcast with Darcy. So, hey, Darcy, how you doing?
Hi.
I don't think I ever Jessica either.
Hey.
I'm just warning everybody that in a minute I will have to switch back to my computer.
That's just fine.
I love, you know what? That's fine because Jim is on with us beautiful and stunning co-hosts who will guide him into this experience. It's fine. It's totally fine.
There you go.
Jim, did I miss your intro?
No, I didn't do one yet.
All right, go ahead.
Do you want to say what people know you from?
I'm on my phone, so I don't, like, I can't do a comprehensive.
Well, anybody who does happen to know me, I do a show called Jim Harold's Campfire, which I've been doing since 2009, and I've been doing the Paranormal Podcast since 2005. As far as I know, and I could be corrected if I'm wrong, the Paranormal Podcast is the longest running paranormal podcast on the internet. I know there, you know, a lot of people, there were a few people before me, they're pretty much gone. Then there's people like Paracast and people started a couple months after me. But as far as I know, I could be wrong. I think it's the longest running paranormal podcast. And I always say the joke is, it used to be the joke was, why are you doing that? Nobody has a podcast. And now the joke is, why are you doing that? Everybody has a podcast. But
it's crazy, right? Like I think about, it's crazy because like yours is, you said 2005, right?
2005.
Yeah. So I did my first one in 2007, and it's such a different world because
it's totally different.
There were like 10, maybe 5,000 podcasts. I almost said 10, but there were like 5,000 podcasts in the whole world.
Yeah, it was nuts. And I mean, I don't know. I mean, I like the way things were then, but I like it now. I like all the technological developments, and I like more people coming in. It doesn't, you know, I don't see it as a negative at all because everybody's got their different spin, their different expertise. I couldn't do what Jessica and John do, and I've got my own little spin on things. So my point is there's room for everybody. So, and there's a lot of cool stuff. I mean, like live streaming. I started live streaming a little bit on Blab, if anybody remembers Blab.
Yep.
And so much stuff has changed, but still, that love of the topic is at the root of it, I think, for all of us. And the more the merrier. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I can't. I know that people, like you said, will sometimes get annoyed because they'll say like, oh, there's so many. It's like, would you rather there be none?
Yeah.
Like there was a time when there wasn't any.
That's right. That's right. I mean, you basically had Coast to Coast AM and that was it. You know, they were not obviously Art Bell and George Norrie. Art Bell was the originator. But that was basically the only game in town if you wanted to listen to paranormal talk. That was basically it. So yeah, you're right. I think it is a great thing we've got. Because I remember, I don't know about you guys, but when I was a kid, I used to go to the paranormal section of the library. And they would have like 1.5 shelves, and the one shelf would be the Time Life books, right? And it's like, where are the rest of the books? Where are the rest of the damn paranormal books? So more is better. More is better.
And then you read through them and be like, are you getting any more? Are you getting any more? No. No.
Well, that was one of the whole reasons, like the first witch that I met, Gundella, the whole reason I kind of met her was because I had read through the paranormal section of my public library. And then I realized that like there were these things called metaphysical conventions, right? There weren't like paranormal conventions. It was metaphysical conventions.
Right.
And I went to one, and they were paranormal conventions. There was a guy there talking about Bigfoot, and there were witches there, and there were people doing crystal healings and Reiki and Carillion photography and like all this. And I was like, oh, these are all my people. This is, they've been hiding in this VFW hall, like down the street.
But to me, you know, that's interesting because like the word paranormal, I think has changed. Like when I started the show in 05, I thought paranormal, like all the things you talked about, I put Bigfoot in there. I put UFOs in there, basically any that was Fortean, anomalous, any of that stuff. And then paranormal became ghost hunting shows and that's it.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. Now people are like, oh, you know, this is the ghost hunting show and I put on a UFO show and it's like, I thought this was supposed to be paranormal. And I'm like, I kind of think UFOs are paranormal along with ghosts and all the other stuff. So I like the big tent philosophy.
100%.
Us too.
Well, I've always had that thing too, where I've talked about, like even the word para, right? So like the fact that para just means alongside of. So when I was introduced to the paranormal, like I always thought that that meant stuff that was alongside of the normal. So that included Bigfoot and UFOs and ghosts and witches and the occult practices and whatever. But yeah, and you know, I think it was after Blair Witch is when it really kicked into ghosts.
Right.
So I think they might have said that they were paranormal investigators. I could be wrong, but that's when all of a sudden it became ghost hunting is paranormal phenomena.
But I think when you said about that, about para, right? The word para or the prefix of para, I guess.
Prefix.
The idea it's alongside, I think that's actually in many cases a really good explanation, I think. Because I think, you know, while I'm in this room and while each of you are in your collective rooms, there might be all kinds of spirits and things that we can't see, like ultraviolet light. It's all here. We just don't sense it. Maybe people with more gifts do. Maybe sometimes you tune in. But I think a lot of this stuff does exist alongside us. So I like that. I like that that turn of phrase.
Yeah. And, you know, it's funny to me because, too, when you do research for a long time, as many of us do, like you realize that if something is paranormal, if it's alongside of normal, and it does get discovered, it does get like science says, oh yeah, this is a real thing. Like, then they take it away from paranormal, obviously, and say, oh, but the rest of it isn't true. Even though So like the Paranormal Research Society that I talked about earlier in the show, this thing, you know, the Society for Paranormal Research back in the 1800s, like they were all the creators of psychology and psychiatry because they were heavy hitters.
They were like big mainstream names.
Yeah, they were the heads of colleges, right? And they were like, let's study human psychology. And well, there was no such thing as psychology. It was psychology and psychiatry was born out of paranormal research.
Yeah. And I mean, we used to have, I remember, you know, watching like really, you know, old shows back in the 70s and stuff. It used to be parapsychologists, you know, on In Search of, they would have a parapsychologist they would be interviewing. And that term has kind of fallen by the wayside. I can't think of many people other than Lloyd Auerbach who still call themselves parapsychologists. And I kind of miss some of that because I don't think there's a thing in the world with ghost hunting and ghost investigation and paranormal investigation. But I'd like to see more of the guys like in the tweed jackets with the elbow patches who are, you know, ruminating over the mysteries of the world. I wish we'd have a little more of that.
And it's important because, like, I'll tell you, in working in academia, right? Like, I have to like gently be like, and I also do this, right? Because it's always got to put this like academic spin on it because somehow the research we're doing is not as highbrow or high context or all these kinds of things. And it's like, no, we're doing good research. Like, I know you've seen sensationalized stuff, but it doesn't mean that there is not a group of us that is actually trying to do really credible work, just like you're all trying to do really credible work in your work.
And the other thing is that where do you draw the line between, for me, having fun with it? Like, as you look at my background, I'm kind of having a little bit of fun. You've got that little planchette up there by the, I don't know which way to point when I'm doing video, but there's that little planchette and a little Bigfoot and a skull and the We're Not Alone thing. So I'm having a little bit of fun with it, but I'm also serious about, so how do you navigate having fun with it, but still being serious about it. And I don't know if I've ever figured that out.
I have a tattoo studio, and I have the same little planchette guy in my tattoo studio on the windowsill.
Yeah, yeah.
I have, I'm doing the same thing, Jim. I've got a little Mothman behind me and Mothman Jr., Godzilla. And I have a We're Not Alone, like, embroidered thing. And then I believe, like, it's in, and that's my work office, right? And so people come in and they know, like, all right, she's into the Tenneth again.
He's back. He's back.
But that's the thing, too. So, I'm sorry to interrupt because I left right when Jim was talking about that. But, like, when I talk about in my lectures, like you have, so like Brian David Josephson, right? He's like a Nobel Prize winning physicist who has studied psychic phenomena for 40 years, like is a real guy, like has, you know, has a fucking stamp in England. Like he's a Nobel Prize winning guy.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's like, this shit is real. And the rest of the scientific community is like, no, it's not. Like, we know it's not real because we haven't studied it.
Well, I had Michael Shermer, like one of the top skeptics, come on the show. And I give him credit. I mean, he had a civil conversation. He was a nice guy, all that. But then I'm like, okay, Dr. Shermer, let's say I agree with you. Let's say that 97% of this stuff can be explained ultimately. We've got to admit, there's still that 2 or 3% that you can't explain, and I can't explain. What about that? And he's like, well, we know about that, but we just put that on a shelf. I'm like, what? What?
Yeah.
That's what you need to take down off of the shelf. And I think he said something like, that's what graduate students are for. But it's like, no, this stuff is real. And you don't have to be, you know, there's this, I'll give you a perfect example. I went for jury duty, almost
just got herself out of it.
18. Well, let me tell you what happened.
18, I didn't go 19, to mine. 18,
18 or 19 years ago, I went, and at the time I was doing the podcasting inside, but I worked for a classical music radio station. And they said, well, what do you do for your job? Blah, blah, blah. Classical music radio station. Okay, great. You're going to be seated. And then maybe 10 years later, when I was doing this full time, he said, what do you do for a living? I'm like, well, I'm a podcaster. What do you podcast on? And I said, very seriously, but I knew what was going to happen. I said, well, actually, I led with Bigfoot. I said, well, I do podcasts on things like Bigfoot and UFOs and ghosts, you know, that sort of thing, the paranormal. And they said, well, thank you so much for your time. And we really appreciate it. You're excused.
Yep.
I'm like, yes, I thought so.
Yeah, I got, this is maybe 10 to maybe 15 years ago now, just because I'm not thinking about time in the right as in my older age, but like 15 years ago I got a notice from Skepticon, which is the biggest like, you know, skeptical convention in the world.
Right.
It was started by James Randi and all this stuff, and they were like, hey, we're thinking about having someone come in and kind of be the foil. Like, can you come into the Skepticon and be on panels and debate like this? And I was like, oh, yeah, sure. And so I sent them some of the stuff that I had written, and we talked about what I was going to talk about. And like a month before Skepticon, they had a voting board. And the person I was in contact with sent me an email and said, yeah, we've gone in another direction. We decided we're not going to have you because we think that you and your topics would be better suited for a more open-minded audience.
I think they didn't pick you because they knew they would have their hands full.
That's true, but I think that maybe true, but I think that that was really telling for them to say, like, but we're not open to thinking outside of our own bubble.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They probably want someone who they could rhetorically beat up on without having any competition. Now, granted, you'd probably been outnumbered 4 or 5 to 1 on a panel, but I think you would have gotten some licks in, and they didn't want that. They wanted someone that they could say, ah, we can twist this person around with our language. And, you know, there's a term.
I think you're right. And I think that one of the things that they kind of probably discussed was the fact that even if I get one really good punch in, that's going to be the one that gets played over and over.
Right. I think that's exactly what happened. Because when I think of you, I think like I look in the mirror and I'm like, Jim, you're a piker. You've been doing this stuff for 20 years, but Tenny knows everything and you know nothing. So my hat's off to you. You are an encyclopedia of Fortiana.
It's going away. I'm getting older. It's floating out of my head into that realm of old age.
Nah.
And yet you just pulled like every actor and actress out of the obscure Billy Zane movie that just mentioned on the last episode. You're like, and Christina Ricci was in that. Eartha Kitt was in it. She did a full number.
It's true. Yeah. The most nonsensical stuff is still in there.
It's all in there. It's all in our brains somewhere. But that's why when you're talking about paranormal stuff, like there's no, it's, where is it? It's not in there. Like that's one of the things that scientists have the biggest problem with, right? It's like they can't find where the thoughts are, where the memories are, where the consciousness is. Like it's just a, you know, 3.5 pound lump of goo sitting in your head doing chemicals. And I don't mean to get too serious on this wacky podcast, but I have rarely seen 100, like whether it's Shermer or like another well-known skeptic who just doesn't believe in anything and only believes like Neil deGrasse Tyson, someone.
Right.
I've never seen them tell the people that they love that they don't actually love them. That when they look at them, they say, I love you. If they believe their bullshit, they should be saying, listen, when I look at you, there's a series of receptors in my brain that do dopamine drops and serotonin release. And so I am pleased to be around you when those chemical reactions in my brain happen. But I'm unable to control it. So like they say, I love you to their children.
Right. Right. Exactly. And there was a great article that Shermer had in Scientific American where he talked about, I think he got married later in life or something. And his, you may be familiar with the article. His wife was very insistent. She had wished that her grandfather could be there, but he had passed on. And they were, I guess, in the family home or something. And there was this radio that the grandfather had.
Oh, it was Ben Radcliffe.
It was Ben Radcliffe?
It was Ben Radcliffe.
Okay.
Who had go ahead. Go with the story. I'm sorry.
Well, the story. Okay. I thought it was Shermer, but the story is that basically the radio never worked. And then that day the radio started working. And then, so they danced together with it. Right? Right. And then the radio never worked again. So that was a sign from the grandfather that he was still around and thinking of her. So
the father died. They took the radio, which hadn't already worked in 10 years. They took it home as a memory of the father, set it up in their house. Then they get married in their home because they're not going to church because they don't believe in anything. And while they're getting married, the radio starts to play.
Yeah.
And they write that off as just, well, you know, the batteries had enough energy right
there. Well, another one is near-death experiences, which are actually probably my favorite thing, because I often say, not everybody's going to see a Bigfoot. Not everybody's going to see a ghost. Not everybody's going to see a UFO. But everybody's going to, you know, time's ticking on all of us. We're all terminal. It's just a matter of time. So the point is, everybody's going to experience that. So I think that's a universal subject. And when you have these NDE folks say, okay, I saw what happened while I was out, while I was flatlining, where I was thought dead, and I could tell you specifically what the medical staff was doing to me while I was unconscious and possibly dead. How do you explain that? They said, well, it's just the throes of a dying brain easing us into the dying process. Bullshit.
Yeah. So that's so as a person, I had a death experience when I was 18. And so I kept up, and I still do, I keep up on all the research of it. And the thing that's amazing to me is that there is this trope, there's this thrown out idea that the throes of a dying brain, right?
Right.
We know that the death experience can't come from, they call it a chemical dump, when you die until your brain just squirts everything. And that's
the hallucinogen. On here.
And supposedly that creates the death experience. But we know, neurobiologists and neuroscientists know, that when that happens, when that chemical dump happens, the brain also becomes incapable of forming memories because it has short-circuited. And so when you come back and you have a memory, it's impossible for you to have a memory if the experience is from the chemical dump.
That's a good point.
I've said dump and squirt a lot.
One more thing I was going to mention about that real quick. I interviewed Bruce Grayson, who wrote the book After. He is a physician, very much a materialist and all that stuff. And one of my favorite stories was one of these people came back from an NDE and said, yeah, I saw the surgeon working on me. He was flapping his arms like a chicken. And Grayson heard this and he thought, oh, this is nuts. This makes no sense. Turns out that in the operating room, he's gloved and gowned and sanitized and sterilized. And when he wanted a particular instrument, so he wouldn't contaminate things, he used his elbows. And he pointed to them. And it looked like he was flapping his wings like a chicken.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we lost Jessica. I bored Jessica to death.
No, no, no. Toad. It's a toad thing.
What a cute.
I don't know how many people have read his work. And I think that he kind of gets lost in the shuffle, but I went and saw him probably three or four times, a physician named Paul Pearsall. Mm-hmm. And Paul Pearsall wrote a book called The Heart's Code, which is all about when people receive transplanted organs and cellular memory. And like that ties into it too. Like there is something that binds us that science, for whatever reason, you said earlier, Jim, you know, that's something for graduate students. When you talk to research scientists, they will tell you when they're doing tests, there are always three outcomes. There is yes, there's no, and there's unknown, because it doesn't work sometimes, or it does work too well sometimes. Mm-hmm. But money is only in researching the yes and the no. There's no money in researching that unknown part of it. And so that it continues to be unknown. Toad's luckily he's got chicken.
Yeah, what's Toad's got to say about it?
Hi, Toady.
Who's that? She said hi to you. She said hi to you.
Well, and I think one of the things that is fascinating about like the NDE like research is that it just keeps getting further and further away from any of their explanations, right? Like it's just like, you're waiting like, oh, is this the thing? Oh no, it's not. You still can't explain this, right? And thinking about people who have come back and similar messages, and again, these memories, flapping your arms like a chicken, like it continues to show like, hey, there is something else going, right? And I was with the students I taught last semester teaching critical thinking. I taught them a book called How to Think About Weird Things, because I want them to think about weird things. And in that book, the authors bring up the fact that scientists used to believe that like lightning wasn't a thing. Like they're right, like that could never happen.
Right.
Like it can't happen. It's not scientifically possible. And then they figured it out, and then they went, oh, okay. But again, it comes into this like, well, unless it's tangible, unless we can have these concrete answers, then it's not real. It's not worth us putting money into things mm-hmm. like that. And that's not the reality of all the things we still don't fully understand.
Go ahead.
No, Jim, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I love science. I think science is great. I mean, right now we're doing a thing that have to be Ted Koppel and have satellite trucks and, you know, live via satellite, you know, all that stuff. And we can do this now out of our houses. I mean, it's amazing. And it's because of science. But it's not a zero sum game. You can respect science, but say, hey, you guys don't understand everything. And you've got to leave that space for the unknown and just say, we don't understand this yet. We're not willing to say it's life after death. We're not, but we don't understand it, so we can't say absolutely no to any possible explanation. There needs to be more of an open mind, I guess, is my point.
I was talking to a friend of mine, and I was saying I set up a thought experiment, which was, okay, so we're born on an island, and there's two groups of people, And there's one group of people who know exactly when the moon is going to change shape and go from full to crescent to half. They also know when the sun is going to go away, right? And then there's another group of people who talk about when the fish people came out of the water, right? And so the people who can prove over and over again that the moon is going to change when it changes and the sun is going to go away when it goes away say that the fish people who believe in the fish people are wrong, right? We would all be very tempted to believe that the people who know when the moon and the sun changes, because they are right and can demonstrate that they are right, are the ones who are right and the fish people don't exist. Okay, now I pull us back, right? And we are people who live on Sentinel Island, okay? And on Sentinel Island, randomly, the most remote inhabited place on the earth, randomly, people in boats will come to the island out of the water. They are the fish people, right? But it hasn't happened in 100 years. So no one has seen the fish people in 100 years. But these guys who know when the moon is going to change, that happens all the time. And so you have this kind of thought experiment where, like, both groups can be right. Just because someone is right doesn't mean the other group is infinitely wrong.
Right. It's that old, isn't it the Arthur C. Clarke quote, advanced enough technology is indistinguishable from magic, but I think it works the other way too. I think it works the other way
100%.
Too. 100%. And here's another little thought experiment. Something I think about a lot is the idea of simulation theory and that we're all in a simulation and those kind of things.
Just talked about that on our last episode.
But here's the thing. I think we're thinking about it wrong, because think about it. Okay, what is a programmer? If a programmer starts with a blank screen and they create a program out of whole cloth, what are they? They're a creator. Right. And if they create a program, let's say that it's a Sims style game and there's people living a life, they are the creator of those people. So essentially, when you say we are a simulation, isn't that maybe just a slightly different way of saying that we are a creation of a greater power?
Right.
I mean, I think it's the two different ways of saying the same thing almost.
100%. One of my mentors was a preacher named Jack Boland, and we used to have Sunday meetups after his Sunday sermon. And he was a Christian minister, but not in any way a Christian minister that I had ever met before in my life. Very open-minded, very loving of everyone, no matter who they were. And I asked him one time, I said, so are there aliens? Like, do you believe in aliens, Jack? And he looked at me and he said, I believe in a creator. And a creator created everything in the universe. And I've never known a painter, a dancer, a composer, a poet that only ever wrote one thing, painted one thing, danced one time, played one song. And so if that creator is a creator, and I believe it to be a creator, it didn't stop with us. That creator loves to create. And so, yes, of course there's aliens.
I love that. That's great.
Obviously not a normal Christian minister.
But I think sometimes these things are more compatible than people think. People say, you do these shows, you know, you do the campfire and you hear all these spooky stories people call in. Aren't you afraid all the time? And I'm like, you know, yeah, they're spooky stories, but I feel better about life and the existence of life after death than I ever have in my whole life, which comes in handy as you get closer to the end. But but the point is that, you know, yeah, I hear plenty of things. Oh, some kind of entity tried to drag me out of bed was when we had this week on the campfire, Jim Harold's campfire, available wherever you find your podcast. Mm-hmm. But also I have the story of, you know, a grandfather getting back in touch with their grandchild. I have the story of a haunted object, but in a good way. You know, all these reassuring. And what I try to tell people, because, you know, and I'm guilty of it. You know, if I have a show that has, you know, 9 or 10 stories a show, I always lead with the scary headline, because sure, that's what gets people to click. But it's almost, I almost look at it as like, okay, I'm going to give you your dessert, but you have to have your vegetables too. And the vegetables are that story about someone who lost their parent. But the parent came back as their 7-year-old childhood ghost to say goodbye, you know, and these different things. So if you're going to get the scary spooky from you, you are, you're going to have to realize too, it's not all about that all the time. There's also the softer side of the
I 100% agree. And I think that Jessica has seen enough of my lectures now. Like she realizes, hopefully she does. Hopefully people who have seen my lectures realize that my lectures are about being kind. They're actually not about ghosts and UFOs and Bigfoot and magic and the occult. It's about being a kind person and being kind to the people around you and the world around you. It's how I sneak it in. I give them a little bit of alien Bigfoots from outer space, and we're going to talk about ghosts, and we're going to talk about time travel and witchcraft. But like it ends, the overarching message is let's be nice to each other.
Right. Yep. That's a good message to have. That's a good message to have. When I started the campfire, I was like, you know, this will just be fun. We'll just be like around electronic campfire and we'll share these stories. But, and again, the show is not unique. There's a million ghost story shows and go back to the old ghost to ghost, you know, with our belt.
Yeah.
And, but the point is I thought it would just be fun, but after a while doing it, I was like, whoa, this people are really taking this seriously in the sense that they're being vulnerable and they're telling stories and they're sharing things like I never told anybody this. And I try to be really respectful of that and try to really try to honor their stories. And, you know, I don't do a Mike Wallace on them. I'm like, well, are you sure it wasn't a leaky faucet? You know, I always try to take their story at face value. And I believe the vast majority of people I talk to, like 98%, are being 100% sincere, whether they really experience something paranormal or not, they're being honest and telling me what happened. And I value that. And I try to respect them and give them that kind of space to tell their stories.
Yeah. I've been trying, I gave up over the past few years, but I went over with a friend of mine. We were trying to discuss how to do ghost stories, Bigfoot stories, UFO stories, and anybody who's going to take this idea, you can take it and run with it. It's yours, whatever, because I obviously haven't been able to figure out how to do it. I've been trying to figure out how to do around the world a kind of moth-style paranormal night where people can sign up. They come to the event, everybody gets 6 minutes or 10 minutes to tell their story. And tonight our story is time travel. Tonight our story is ghosts. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to give us your name. You can just get up in front of a crowd of accepting people and tell your story without judgment and get it out of your system.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I think that's a great idea because I think that more times than not, it not only does it serve the storyteller, it serves the people listening because they'll go, oh, I thought I was the only one who experienced that.
Yep.
I mean, I had a story of a guy who said and this was probably in the late 60s when he was a little kid, that he would see a leprechaun. He swore he saw a leprechaun and he held that for 20 years. And he's like, oh, I must be crazy. This has got to be something going on with my mind. I'm imagining this. And then maybe 20 years later, he was having dinner with his brother. And he said, I got something to tell you. Something weirdest thing happened to me when we were kids. I used to see a leprechaun at night. And the guy's brother said, oh, you saw him too. And he wasn't joking. He was dead serious. Yeah. Now, to me, wasn't an actual leprechaun. I'm not convinced it was a leprechaun. But could have it been some other kind of a being presenting itself in such a way? Could have it been a screen memory? You know, who knows? But I believe he was seeing something and it was validated by his brother. And all those years he carried that and thought, oh, I'm crazy. I'm nuts. You know,
I tell a story, Jim, at my lectures about the first time that I did a lecture that my parents saw. My parents hadn't seen me. I'd been lecturing for 20 years and they had never seen me lecture. And the first time they came to a place to see me lecture, I was going to have to recount an experience where I saw an elf. Like, all of the weird shit I've ever talked about. And in front of my parents, I have to talk about this elf experience. And I went up on stage and was fearless. And I just told the story as it happened. After the event was over, I went home with my parents. They said it was okay. My lecture was fine. People seemed to like it, is what my dad said. People seemed to like it. We went back to their house in Northern Michigan. And that night, my dad came out of his bedroom at 11 o'clock at night, sat down on the couch next to me, and started telling me that he thought we had never gone to the moon. And when he got up and went to bed, my mom came out and told me a ghost story that she had never told me in her whole life, and then went to bed. And it was seeing someone tell their story that made them tell things that they had never told anyone.
Well, it reminds me of my parents, because my parents, my family was from West Virginia, salt of the earth. My dad worked in a steel mill. I grew up in Cleveland, which is not unlike Detroit. I grew up in the city. I didn't live on the wrong side of the tracks. I looked out my window and I saw the tracks. Right. So I lived not in the best neighborhood. So salt of the earth people, they weren't getting in touch with the oneness of the universe, didn't have a pyramid under their bed, nothing like that. So there were two family stories they told me. The first one was back in West Virginia one time. My dad and mom went out to a lover's lane kind of thing and left baby Jimmy with the grandparents. Now, I don't know why they went out there. I don't think I want to know. But anyway, anyway, it's pitch black. And anybody been in one of those rural areas, they know it is totally black, right? Yep. It is dark, dark, not like city dark, like country dark. Right. So anyway, they said all of a sudden, the sky lit up. And my dad had like a 68 Buick LeSabre with the big speedometer. And he said, could read the numbers on the speedometer and a clock. And that lasted for 30 to 60 seconds. Then my dad says, to the his side of the car, there was a man with what he called a welding mask who held his hand up. And then at that point, they said, we're getting out of here. My dad, you know, burns rubber and starts going down the road. And then in my mom's words, in her accent, God rest her soul, she said, then Jimmy, I went and I looked, and on that bank, it was the biggest bunch of birds I've ever seen with the biggest wings I ever saw in my life. Now, years later, talking to Mike Cloland, who I know that you're all familiar with the owls and all that, I said, Mike, I told him a story. Could that have been a screen memory? I never thought about that. That could have totally been a screen memory.
Yep. 100%.
And the thing was, my mom and dad, steel worker, and it's not the correct term now, but she was a stay-at-home mom. Let's put it that way. At that point, they would have called a homemaker. Very like not my dad liked to watch In Search Of once in a while. That was about it. So that's one. The other one was about 10 years. That was
keep
about
talking. I can hear you.
About 1970. 10 years before that, my dad and my uncle lived up over a bar. They were in Cleveland in this industrial area. Young guys just starting out. They had an apartment over a bar. So anyway, it's a very small, like two room, place, right? Walk up. And my dad's asleep, my uncle's asleep. There's one way out, one way in. My dad wakes up at the time. He's a big guy. He's like 6 foot tall. He's probably 25 years old, played football, strong guy, steel worker. All of a sudden, he sees a guy, an older guy, looking down upon him as he wakes up, and he's smiling at him. And my dad, you know, just came out of the army. Bam! He would have had him. Air, nothing. My uncle, who was a year older, 2 inches taller and bigger, and kind of a total skeptic, even more so than my dad, he's like, what the hell are you going on about? What's going on in there? And my dad's like, there was somebody in here. There's somebody in here. And they look around. There's nobody in here. You had a damn dream. 2 weeks later, my dad's asleep. My uncle's asleep. My dad wakes up and hears my uncle scream, what the hell? Get out of here. Same thing. My dad, my uncle was bigger and stronger, and he swung, and there was nothing there. Same guy showed up. And then they come to think that maybe this was a guy who used to go to the bar, and they used to buy him drinks, and the guy passed away. That's what they're thinking it was. Those were two stories. I think that kind of, that, and I was told those from the time I was like 5 years old. story's never changed. My uncle passed, unfortunately. My mom passed, unfortunately. Dad's still with us, 88 years old. Still tells us exact same story. I could get him on the phone right now and he'd tell you exactly the same thing. And he would say something like, well, Jimmy, I don't know what you call it, but I know what I saw. Mm. So, I mean, the thing was, is that I value these stories from people. And I think there's this someone else I was talking about, and I'm doing exactly what Darcy said a while ago not to do. I can't remember who it was. I'm sorry. Someone I was talking about, maybe it was Kelly Chase of the UFO Rabbit Hole podcast, I think, that we tend to totally discount witness testimony. And I know they say witness testimony in criminal cases, some of the most unreliable testimony you can get, but we kind of just throw it out. And I don't think that's right, because it should count for something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's that skeptic mantra of, you're making an extraordinary claim. I need extraordinary evidence. And there's a YouTube clip people can watch online, and it's a debate between Rupert Sheldrake and Richard Dawkins. So obviously two diametrically opposed people. Yeah. And at some point, Rupert is talking about paranormal experiences, and Dawkins says to him, you're making extraordinary claims. I demand some extraordinary evidence. And without missing a beat, because they're both scholars and they're both, you know, very well-educated people, without missing a beat, Rupert turns around and looks at him and says, you have just said that millions of people over thousands of years are incorrectly interpreting their own personal experiences. That sounds very much like an extraordinary claim. Do you have any extraordinary evidence to back it up?
So good. It's so good.
And it's over. The debate is over. Like, Dawkins leaves.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't have it.
That's amazing. That is absolutely amazing.
I want to bring something up. Jim, I know, aside from like your billion podcasts that you have also brought in your wife and your daughter.
Yeah. It's like become like a family business almost.
Yeah.
My wife does a podcast with me called You Won't Believe What Happened to Me. And we might be doing something a little bit different with that soon, but we're going to continue to do. And she works part-time for the business now and does our mausoleum of merch and that kind of stuff. My oldest daughter actually does a show called Unpleasant Dreams, where she takes classic horror stories and retells them. It's called Unpleasant Dreams. And she's done Poe and folks like that. What was the most recent? Did one called The Night Wire just recently, which is from 1926. And it's about a teletype operator that has a very bizarre experience. So she tells those kind of stories. And then my youngest daughter, we have fun. My youngest daughter actually edits The Campfire.
Oh, wow.
That's awesome.
Yeah, she
that's
goes cool. to Ohio State, but I get her I get the files into the cloud to her every week, and I've taught her to edit, and she's been editing for the company for about 5 years. Wow. So, yeah, so we've got a little mini factory going here, and really that's enjoy awesome. It because I think we all have an interest in this stuff, particularly my wife, I know, has a great interest in it, and it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. It's enjoyable.
Yeah.
I'll have to send you a copy of, I rewrote a bunch of fairy tales into a book called Cinder Wench and the Blue Beast, I think it's the Blue Beast.
Oh, that's neat.
And it takes mostly Charles Perrault's fairy tales and it twists them into a way where they're not about a damsel in distress. They're about damsels who take care of their fucking shit. And don't need to be saved by a prince or anyone.
It's really good.
Oh, that sounds good. I like it. That's excellent. I was going to ask you guys, like, Jessica and John, what's it like doing a podcast together? I mean, you guys have different ways of looking at things, different styles and stuff. What's it like doing a podcast together?
We're just best friends. It's very real. I feel like it's so effortless that people think it's scripted and it's not. There's no planning. There's no notes. There's no anything. It's literally, I haven't talked to my best friend in 4 days and this is what we're talking about. And it's right. Everything. It's like 98% unedited. You know, it's,
yeah, it's the only edits that happen are I take out her sniffing.
Yeah.
I take out any long pauses as yeah. I think for an answer to one of her questions.
Yeah.
But aside from that, like when we started this, I really wanted people to just hear friends talking. And right. I feel like it's yeah. succeeded in that.
Well, I agree with you. Like on my shows, we do editing for sound. Like we clean up the sound of the callers because people sometimes will call in on a potato, believe it or not. And, and even with interviews, I mean, it's like, it's not like, well, I answer that again. No, it's like, I want to do it. Basically the old term is live to tape, basically. Yeah. You know, I say if the UPS person comes or you get in a coughing jag, we'll take that. Right. Out. Otherwise this is basically live to tape. I mean, Darcy, what I always think when somebody does.
I don't mean to interrupt, Jim. I'm sorry. I can only think of one instance when I took out a conversation and I took it out because it was something that was on the podcast that Jess and I fixed later, like mm-hmm. talking to each other yeah. as friends. But if I would have just left the conversation in, it would have seemed odd that it wasn't fixed within the podcast.
Right. 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 Does right. Right. Sense? Yeah. That makes sense.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm talking about when you and you want me to give it away.
I don't care.
I
don't have any secrets.
Jess and I, yeah, we don't have any secrets. Jess and I got into a conversation about the slap, the Will Smith slap.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah,
yeah.
Yeah. And it wound down a road for probably 30 minutes. And at the end of that part of the conversation, there was no...
There was an impasse.
It was an impasse. And so I was like, this is going to be terrible to listen to because people are going to feel like we fought and didn't rectify it. And we did.
Right.
You know?
Right. Right.
We don't agree on everything.
No, we don't agree
on everything. Nobody agrees on everything.
Different standpoints, different eras, different genders. There's a lot of stuff that we teach each other and it plays out fully on the podcast.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. And I'm always interested how other podcasters feel about, like Darcy, with you, what has surprised you? I mean, I know stuff has surprised me in doing this. What has surprised you in doing your show?
You know, when I was doing the Mysteries Decoded podcast, which was, you know, it was a network format, right? And so I, like Tenny can tell you, we talked for like 2+ hours, right?
Make it yeah.
to 15 freaking minutes, right? But I think one of the things that, I don't know if it surprised me as much as I'm just grateful for it, is the incredible connections I made with people in things outside of like what we were talking about, right? Uh-huh. Because like, yes, we were talking about like paranormal things at that time, but like, I think about having Dr. Andrea Kidda on to talk about black-eyed children, because like our president was like all up on like, we got to have an episode about black-eyed children. I'm like, okay. And so, you know, but she and I had this whole conversation about the work I do around death, dying, and grief. And then she was like, oh, you've got to meet these people and you have to get in with the folklorist. And I'm like, I'm not a folklorist. And she's like, no, like they're great. And so making these other connections with these other people that's led me down paths has been really incredible. And, you know, the fact that like Jessica, Tenny, and I are like friends in real life.
Yeah.
Is so amazing to me. Like, I am so incredibly grateful for the fact that, like, you know, you were talking about this would have taken trucks and like Ted Koppel and all of these things all
yeah.
these years, right? But I'm so grateful. And I think like the little kid in me is really grateful that I have gotten to meet all my weirdo best friends, all the people I was like hoping for existed in the world exist in the world. And so I get to like be cozy. You know, we talk, we like Justin didn't use the word cozy all the time, and I have now adopted it because of WooPod. But like, you know, I was telling them like last night, I'm on the way to do a haunted tour, and I put them on because for me, it's not just about getting in like strange stuff headspace, but it's like, oh, I get to hang out with my friends a little bit before I go do this thing. Right. Because in real life, we're probably not going to get to see each other for a few more months. And that, I think, has been what is so remarkable. And like to your point earlier of like, there's space for everyone. Right. Watching more and more people come in and welcome each other in and be open-minded and say like, I want you to live in your truest identity, and I want you to be able to express who you are in your fullest being. And it can talk about music and, you know, toy, like just everything that we all talk about. Like, I'm so grateful for this community. And it's just, I think it's been one of the best things that podcasting as a whole has done, because it's connected people in ways that they never expected. And I think for so many people, they know they're not alone, right? Like we were talking about that, right? Like this idea of, and it's something that I share that, you know, Tenny talks about all the time. It's like their experience is enough, right? Mm-hmm. Their experience is enough that it changed their life. Because if you really think about it, that's what it did, right? That experience was this marked moment that they're, you know, going back to like True Detective season 2, which was not the best True Detective season, but there is a moment where Vince Vaughn's character is talking about death and loss, and he says, you know, there's a moment when things happen, and there's everything that comes before, and there's everything that comes after. And I think that is so much about these experiences for people. And I think that people feeling community, feeling kindness, feeling people being nice to one another and saying you are seen and you are heard and your story is important saves people's lives. It does.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. I just saw where somebody said that that your guys' show helped them through their journey. And I think when you hear that as a content creator, you're like, whoa, it's like, because you don't think of it that way, but it does, it's true. And I can even remember, like, you know, when I was first out on my own and I didn't have a lot of friends or whatever, you know, my company at that time was the radio. And there are people out there who don't, and Larry King, the old talk show host, and most people knew him from CNN, but for years he was on the radio and did a late night talk show before Coast to Coast AM came around. And, he told this story where essentially, and I don't know how true this is because it sounds a little cooked up.
Right.
But basically he put, he had been approached by a woman to have a liaison, let's say, during his air shift. So he put on, you know, and this is way back. So he's like, here's the long playing record, the new record by Harry Belafonte. So anyway, apparently he went to another room or part of the radio station to have this little tryst. And then the time he knew the record was coming to an end, so he ran back to the thing, and there was a scratch on the record. And it was going, where the nights, where the nights, where the nights. And then like the next day or something, he got a call from someone. And he said, hey, I want you to know I listen to your show. You're like my company every night. And last night, you're my only company. I'm blind. And I don't know what happened, but I had to listen to Where the Nights multiple times. And on one hand, it could be funny. But what King meant was, is that he never took his responsibility lightly again. Because he realized that he was that lifeline for some people. He was their friend. And I know when I've met people in other genres who, like Leo Laporte, is a tech journalist, and he has a, mm-hmm. a line of tech podcasts and kind of been like my podcasting idol. And when I met him, I'm like, oh my God, it's Leo Laporte. Oh my God. Right. And there's people who, weirdly enough, think about me that way, which I'm totally mm-hmm. like shocked and blown away by and don't understand quite, but I thank them. But the point is I think when you're doing this, the one thing I do think is a little bit of a danger is when people who don't realize that with much power comes much responsibility. Right. And you have one of these mics in front of you. You have a certain amount of power, even if your audience is 10 people, 100 people, 1,000 people, 10,000 people, 100,000, so on and so forth. You have power. So I think anybody who's going to be a podcaster ought to think about, when I'm doing this, how can I contribute to people's lives and not hurt people, but help people? And I think that's really important.
That yeah. is so important, Jim. And like the one thing, you know, we have fun on our podcasts and when we chat and stuff, but words matter. And how we, like, my goal at the end of the day is to never be a person who makes, I don't want to be the straw that breaks the camel's back, right? Like, I never want to be the person that kicks somebody when they're down or mock somebody. Like, I'm not, like, I will make fun of myself,
right?
But sure. like, I don't, you know, I don't want to make fun of other people. I don't want to pick the low hanging fruit. And that, I think, was one of the things that was really important to me when I was looking into different folks, because again, I was getting pitched a lot of people, and I start researching and vetting people, because I knew that by having somebody on, whether I said I condone them or not, it's right. saying I condone them. I think that this is okay. And I think yeah. that we have such responsibility in the ways that we conduct ourselves, associate ourselves, like it's so important in so many ways. Like, you bring up such an incredible, like, that's such a great anecdote, but it's so, so important.
I have one. Go ahead, sir.
Oh, I was just going to say, it reminded me of something. So there was a lecturer that used to come named Og Mandino. He's a author that I used to go and see. And I remember I was probably 19 the one time that I saw him lecture, and he said, if you were sitting at a table with someone and you knew that, you 100%, you knew that that person, that would be the last time you talked to them because they were going to die in the next hour, how would you talk to that person and how would you leave that conversation? Because when you talk to people, there is the possibility you will never speak to them again. Mm. And so every time you talk to someone, you leave the conversation, you would have left that other conversation, knowing that you might never speak to that person again. And what will your last words to that person be? That's the way you should approach every conversation with everyone you speak to. Pretty heavy at the end of this.
Yeah, don't I was going to ask you about black eyed kids, but I don't know if I can now.
Well, Jess, do we have to do, we have well, 4 minutes.
We have to do a thing. Hey. We're going to have to go over, so too bad.
Okay.
Well, I did want to ask about, do you think the black eyed kids, do you think they're possibly the djinn? That was.
Oh. Bad.
Oh, you know, so in the 90s and early 2000s, so I live probably, how far are we from Dearborn?
Like 30 minutes.
Yeah, like 30 minutes away from Dearborn, Michigan, which is the largest Arabic community outside mm-hmm. of the Middle East. And so I would get djinn calls a lot. I don't think black-eyed kids are djinn. I think that black-eyed kids are very much more probably some kind of aggregated emergent after the stories were written about black-eyed kids and people started to read about them. I think that if anything, they were probably forced into existence.
Like a Tulsa or a thought form?
Yeah,
for sure. I know that people use thought form and talpa a lot. For some reason in my brain, I always use the word emergent because it's like mm-hmm. they emerged into this reality, right? Mm-hmm. And then mm-hmm. back out. But yeah, it's always funny because people like that outside of Dearborn, I would go to a place and they would be like, yeah, our water pipes are always busted, or like things in our house randomly and spontaneously catch on fire. And I'm like, oh, you have a fire gin in your house, or oh, you have like a water gin in your house. Like, and it's just one of those things with, you know, as you grow up in communities that have religious belief systems that say this thing is this thing and this thing is that thing, you realize like, oh, so people are having those experiences and just calling them different names.
Yeah.
Like, it's not a poltergeist. You have like a wind djinn in your house. Like, it's just knocking things over. It's not a poltergeist, but it is a poltergeist, but it's also a djinn. It's just the words.
You know, Tenny, that reminds me, and I know, Jess, you all have to do something, but one of the things I've changed on the tour because of you is we have a shadow person story, right? And people get all weirded out about shadow people. And I tell the story, but they said, but also, thanks to my friend Tenny, who shared that in Middle Eastern thought, it is not creepy, it is not bad, it is the light of heaven.
Yeah.
So shining brightly behind your loved one that you can't see them.
Right, that they're silhouetted.
Yeah, to watch everyone go, oh,
yeah,
like that's beautiful, right? And so it's like, what is one person's poltergeist or djinn or one person's creepy experience is another person's silhouetted loved one in the afterlife.
Yeah, 100%.
Awesome.
Can you, hey, briefly, can you guys all say hi to my dad? He's texting me this whole time. And hi.
Hi, Dad.
Everybody in the chat, listen, my dad comes up a lot on the podcast. He's my favorite person. I hope you guys can meet him at an event one time. He's the best.
Is he going to stay around for this?
I don't know. He'll probably go to bed soon.
Is he going to stay around for this big announcement?
Oh, God, I forgot. I don't know. It's embarrassing. I don't know.
Jess, do you want us to be off screen for your big announcement?
Probably not, but you don't have to go right away. It doesn't matter. We're already over.
I'll tell you what. I'll take them out, the announcement, and then bring them back.
No, they're not going to come back. They got to go about their evening.
Okay, they can go about their evenings.
I can come back if you want me to, but if you want to move on, that's okay too. It's up to you.
Well, let's go like 10 more minutes and then we'll do our thing.
Okay.
Are we still live?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Aren't we? All right. Is it y'all?
We're live.
YouTube, it's not going to cut us off until we stop, right?
I don't know.
I don't think it should.
We're going to find out.
People are like, all right. That's what's a bad call in.
I don't know how this technology works.
Clearly based on the in and out and your computer updating.
So wait, do you want me to take them out and do the announcement and then bring them out?
No.
Come on.
Clearly based on
No.
Okay.
Right. They can wait. Everybody's just chilling.
Okay.
Oh.
We have to do a Patreon only after this, though, remember.
What now?
We have to do a Patreon only after this, remember.
I know. You know, whatever you want to do. If you want to keep talking about heaven and dead people for 10 minutes, whatever you're trying to do.
I know. We went from like the lightest, like simple and all, and puppets, and oh my God, Alex Twitter to like.
I brought the whole vibe down.
I brought it all down.
I just love but this is like the highs and lows. So for folks that have not been, I would say, in like Michigan was my first like big convention this past year. Like, this is how the nights go.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be there this year. I'm gonna be there this year.
Jim, thank God.
I'm gonna finally show up.
Thank goodness.
Thanks to Nina.
Yeah, it does. The nights revolve. They go from like the wackiest thing to like the darkest thing, back to the wackiest thing, to Lord of the Rings.
Yeah. To Lord of the Rings. Mm-hmm. Always Lord of the Rings. And you know, that's okay. That's okay. Which Jessica, see, when people are like, they agree on everything. Jessica's still not watched Lord of the Rings.
No, I'm not doing that.
And Tenny only finally for the first time watched Titanic past year. So
that was so fun.
Yeah. I will tell you right now that for one of the guests, I did reach out to Billy Zane's management.
Come on.
Tenny!
You listen, if you didn't tell me to get my most ready, come on.
Why didn't she let him hang on the piece of wood? I don't understand. That's why I don't get about Titanic.
There was room.
There was room.
There was
room.
Why
didn't he just let him?
I got plans. It's fine. It's fine. Things are gonna happen.
Just like Tenny, I am constantly, because of how weird life is and people just, you know, all of a sudden I met that person. I am constantly trying to find the Billy Zane connection for you.
No, I already have one. Fucking Aaron Sagers has the same manager.
Okay. Sagers, hello.
I know.
Make this happen.
I think he does. Yeah, I think he does.
Well,
now you know who your real friends are.
Yeah. You don't have the same manager as Aaron's. I don't even have a manager.
It's gonna organically happen. It's fine. Don't make it awkward.
Tenny and I are not gonna make it awkward. Make it awkward, but Tenny and
I will be everything. I'll say it again. Tenny is a tremendous wingman.
Yes.
But so am I. I'm a good wingman too.
I am also a good wing person, and I try and like explain this to like guy friends.
To LA again, because I know all the places. I know all the places that he hangs. And Tenny, we were one block away from his art studio, and I didn't know.
Well, I would like to, next time you all are out, I'm hoping to set up a different lunch for you.
Yeah, we're going to come out again. We just have to figure it out to where we don't kill each other.
Well, I think also, too, if we can find a way to, like, would you fly with Toad?
Tenny would fly, I would drive. That's the problem. But it's fine. It'll be fine.
But she would drive without all the stops she made last time.
Yes.
Oh, like more of a straight shot? Okay. Yeah.
Last time I went to UFC in Salt Lake and stayed for 5 days and did all the fucking things and went to Yosemite and went to Sequoia and did fucking 15,000 things. And then by the time I saw you guys in LA, I was brain dead.
Yeah. And you two had also
twist her arm. I had to twist her arm to go to the grave of Superman.
No, you almost gave up, and I said, no, we're going because you want to.
Was that George Reeves? Reeves?
Yeah.
George
Reeves'
grave, yeah.
He was murdered. That wasn't
We went to the mausoleum.
Yeah, he was murdered.
But you two haven't been to Hollywood Forever yet? We're
dedicated to
bringing literally four blocks away. We went to the Rainbow Room. It's like down the street.
The Rainbow. It's not the Rainbow Room. The Rainbow Room is in New York.
Or Rainbow, excuse me.
The Rainbow. Because Lemmy, you got to see Lemmy's statue and understand that he lived upstairs.
You were drunk and there was like corn and Limp Bizkit on. It was like a lot.
But see, when you all come back out, the other thing I want to do, and I talked to Tenny about this, is I want to make the Magic Castle happen for you.
No, I want to go.
So
do we still have to wear skirts and not pants?
You can wear pants.
You can wear pants.
You just have to wear it.
Rule, and I thought that was shitty.
Fancy pants. Yeah, it's called the patriarch.
Yeah, it's stupid.
But
and I can get in because I'm a magician.
Why yes. Not? Oh, ooh.
Because I can do all right, stupid card tricks.
Jim, Darcy, do you have anything else you want to... I'm going to put your socials and everything under the video.
Thank you.
Do
you
have anything else you want to plug or say or do anything?
Well, thank everybody. Thank you for having me on the show. Stay safe and stay spooky.
Yeah.
Jim, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you.
Yeah. This has been a blast, y'all. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thank you. Guys.
Thanks, Darcy. Love you.
Love you. I'll talk to y'all soon.
Bye-bye. Okay.
Bye.
Bye. Oh, yeah. I'm exhausted.
I'm exhausted, too.
And we still have to do a Patreon after show.
I know.
It'll be fun. Are you guys having so much fun out there?
Is everybody having so much fun now that we are 7 minutes over?
I know. We blew it. We're motor mouth.
Now everybody left and nobody's going to see the announcement.
No, they're gonna. This is a lot of people still. All right, you guys. You know that we did a thing last year called Win a Date with John Tenney. So, like...
Let's stop there.
You know where this is going.
Let's stop there.
Groan. Hashtag groan.
Ready?
I'm going to hide. I'm leaving. All right, well, it's happening, you guys. It's happening. Obviously, it's Win a Date with Jessica, but it's also Toad and Tenny, too. I'm not just being hung out to dry all by my fucking self.
Just for your safety.
Just for my safety.
Did you like my video I made?
Yeah. I knew. I felt something coming. Tickets are on sale now. If you a ticket to enter, be chosen to, we will fly you to Michigan to hang out with us for a couple days, put you up in a hotel, pay for everything that we do together. Ultimate OPOD fun time hangout. Tenny, do you want to put up the website or the?
Oh, I'm just putting up the Linktree.
Yeah. So if you guys go to linktree.com/whatsupweirdo, you can find our Patreon to watch the after show of this show in like half an hour after we go pee and let the dog out and slam food in our mouth. And then I'll see you.
Pizza over here. I never ate it because we had so many guests.
I got to shove a cosmic brownie right in my mouth hole.
You know what? I made brownies today. Look.
I want brownies.
I made brownies today.
I'm going to drive over and get a brownie and then drive back and then do the after show. No, I'm not. but yeah, so the ticket link is at the Linktree, along with everything else that you'll need to find us, socials, etc. Yeah.
And you can win a date with Jessica.
Oh my God. I'm going to have to put this on Twitter. It's going to be so embarrassing.
Are you going to put the video?
Not the video. No, I'll put the graphic.
I'll put the video on.
No, I don't have to put the video. You're just not waiting to eat. You're just doing it right now. But yeah, I can't wait to see who wins. Our first contest was such a success, and our winner was like the best case scenario. And Cass, shout out Cass. Hi.
I can't stop it. I don't know how.
For fuck's sake, I removed it. Toad cannot go to the zoo, unfortunately, but that is one of our options. Oh, listen, let me tell you guys. You know how in one of our Patreon videos, we go to that crazy rummage sale, the church rummage sale. Listen, when we draw the winner of this, the winner of the contest will be drawn on April 19th. You have till April 19th to buy tickets. The rummage sale is a couple weeks after that. So we figure if you want to come here for that, you can come with us to the fucking crazy church rummage sale. That's like our favorite thing. And then like
rummage.
And we could go to the zoo and we could go to Olive Garden or wherever the fuck and do all the things. So that's on the table. Obviously, look, everybody's like church rummage sale. Yeah, it's like our favorite fucking thing. So that is an option for the winner. Obviously, we will coordinate it with when you're able to come, but hopefully that is an option. That's why I planned it for this timing, because I would love for the person to come with us. Yeah, we could go to the dollar store. We could go to the post office. We could go to Gustling Alley. We could go to Oak House Deli, where our favorite vegan sandwiches are.
Look at the people are demanding the commercial be played.
No, it's again. Really loud. You have mixed it really loud. I know we're going to go on a crime spree. We'll go on a collective crime spree at the church and steal and not pay for anything that we got.
Don't do that.
That'll be included in your prize. We'll go to Tenny's dusty ass bank. I drank
all of this cranberry and vodka.
We'll go to Tenny's dusty bank that doesn't have debit cards.
That's where I was going when I went to the cemetery. I walked there.
Best ever. Rummage sale. Rummage best word. Yep. Gasoline is given. Yup. Olive Garden. Yup. Dang, you guys bought tickets already? It's been 5 seconds. Also, so like I said, it goes till April 19th. So if you don't have money right now, you can wait or you can like whatever, stretch it out. I know it's tough out there right now. So listen, don't think that you have to enter anything. It's just, it supports the podcast. It supports our equipment. Listen, I was thinking when Jim Harold was on, I'm like, I'm literally asking Jim Harold where he got his microphone and I'm getting the same microphone because they sounded great.
Listen, I'm just saying twice I had to be on my phone.
I know you're falling apart the whole show. It's okay. It worked out. It's live. People get it. We're just doing our best. Best contest ever. Oh yeah. And that was another, why am I so big? Get out of here. Okay, anyway, that was another thing I wanted to bring up that's like in the fine print of the contest. If you live outside of the United States, so wherever you want to, I almost said drive, wherever you want to fly to that's like cheapest for you within the continental United States, we will fly you from there to us. So if you, oh God, if you fly yourself to the United States, we'll fly you to Michigan and pay for your hotel and your and everything that we do. And we can do whatever you want. And then I said, too, in the words that you can either plan the trip yourself. Whatever you want to do here, we'll do it. We can plan it or you can plan it or a little bit of both. So if I win, you'll fly me from Windsor. No, we will fly you from the United States. We can't fly you from out of the country.
No. And besides, you're in Windsor. Drive through the
tunnel. Yeah, literally drive the fuck over here.
I mean, come on.
And oh yeah, that's the thing. If you win and you don't want to fly and you want us to pay for your gas, that is a thing too. You don't have to fly. We're not making you fly. We'll pay for your gas or your whatever you want to do. Hotels on the way, etc. That was the joke. They said that was a joke. We didn't get it. We're stupid. We're stupid.
We are pretty stupid.
So yeah, that's the announcement. Hope you stuck around for that. We will be having a Patreon after show briefly. Probably in like a half an hour, I will go on the Patreon and put a link to our after show. I have a few things to do in the meantime. I have to put my hair up because I fucking hate having my hair on my face.
I can't believe everybody showed up.
I know we had the best guests. Listen, I swear to you, every live show we have, everybody in the chat's like, this is the best one ever. This is the best one ever. This is the best one ever. But guess what? They're all the best one ever. So
they are the best one ever. You never know what's going to happen. Everybody was so fucking synced.
I know. I know. And there were so many good ghost stories and UFO stories and like movies and TVs and all the things that we had to talk about. This was great.
All right.
What a joy. What a joy.
What a joy. Let's go to the bathroom, eat pizza, do what we got to do.
Toad is curled right here.
Toad's out.
Curled. Curled. Okay. All right. So, yeah. Give us, when should the Patreon after show start? 9:45? Or 10.
Is that it gives us a half an hour?
Yeah, 9:45. Okay, we'll see you. I'm going to come in there with a link and put it on there, and then you guys join us in the Patreon after show, and we'll talk shit about whatever we feel like. We'll talk about
everybody. Thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching. Thanks for spending your Friday with us. It was so cute and fun.
I can't believe you spent Friday with us. I've had way too much cranberry vodka.
I could use another drink. I've been trying to go slow, so I didn't.
Look how big this is.
Yeah, I didn't make a picture like you. I've had two drinks and two of these.
You know what else? If people have been noticed, you know what I got over here as snacks for my snacks?
What?
We got oyster crackers.
Come on.
That looks boring. And I got shortbread cookies.
Yeah, that looks really boring.
I got brownies that I made too.
Wait, was your surprise the video, or did you have a different surprise?
No, it was the video.
Okay. Good job.
All right. We'll see everybody in the Pates 30 minutes from now.
Yeah. See you in the after show. If not, we'll see
you. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Hope you had fun.
Okay. We love you very much.
All right. We're all done. Love you. Mwah.
Bye.
That was to everybody, not you, Jess.
No, fuck you.
Bye.
Bye.